The Auburn Tigers started the 2007 season on the right note, defeating Kansas State last week. But the win did not come easy. Trailing deep into the fourth quarter, star defensive end Quinton Groves ended K-State's upset bid.
Here comes pressure. Groves! Ball loose! Picked up! Coleman's gonna go the distance! Touchdown! Auburn! How about that Quinton Groves?
In only their seventh season in Division 1A, upsets are nothing new to South Florida. 2006 Big East Freshman of the Year Matt Grothy led his team into Morgantown last year, and the Bulls upset West Virginia.
Throw over the middle. Too high. Picked off. USF has it. They have beaten number 7 West Virginia.
It's South Florida and Auburn under the primetime lights, and it's right now. Welcome, Jordan Hare Stadium in Auburn, Alabama. First ever meeting between the University of South Florida and 17th ranked Auburn Tigers. Hello, everybody. I'm Dan Fouts along with my partner, Tim Brandt. Both teams got off to a good start last week, but they had to struggle just a little bit. And college football loves upsets. We might have one here tonight, Tim.
Well, everybody's talking about that, Dan. They're talking about an upset. But I'll guarantee you, South Florida didn't get off the bus holding hands today. This is a confident football team. And everybody's talked about the upsets. They've talked about trap games. This is the paper here in Auburn. Big East, USF predicted to upset the Tigers. Are you kidding me? Well, this is really going to be about strength versus strength. The offense of South Florida against the defense of Auburn. And that means Matt Grothy, the quarterback. He became a cult figure last year when his highlights made YouTube, but he threw 14 interceptions last year. If he does that today, he's got trouble, and I guarantee you they'll be chasing him down like number 54. You know who that is? That's Quinton Groves. He's an All-American. He's going for the record tonight. He needs 2 sacks. All right, that's the matchup. But this is the story. This crowd, this scene, this atmosphere. This is what's going to prevent an upset tonight.
87,541, and every seat is full. This playing surface is natural grass. It's lightning fast, just the way the Tigers like it. Tommy Tuberville is the head coach of the Tigers now in his 9th year. He's led the Tigers to 6 straight bowl games. On the other side of the field is the only coach the Bulls have ever had, and that's Jim Leavitt. They finished 4th in the Big East last year when their first ever bowl game by beating East Carolina in the PapaJohns.com Bowl 24-7. This is the largest on-campus, or the 7th largest on-campus stadium in college football.
Auburn won the toss and deferred. They want to get that defense on the field right out of the gates.
That means Taris Johnson will be back deep for the Bulls. Zach Kutch will kick it off for the Tigers. And this place is ready to explode.
Tommy Tuberville is concerned about this new rule, too, kicking off from the 30.
Jerome Murphy with the return out to the 35-yard line. Good return. That's why Tuberville was concerned with the kickoff. Moving it back to the 30. Going to get a lot more long returns.
Dan, now we'll see in this first series whether South Florida goes with the no huddle. That's what Grothy likes. He likes to get into a rhythm, go no huddle. Although, Jim Leavitt was telling us he doesn't think they're going to do it because of the noise in here. We'll see here in this series. Grothy needs some early success. South Florida needs some early success and no negative plays.
And Jim Leavitt feels the advantage the Bulls have is that man right there in the shotgun, number 8, Matt Grothy. Benjamin Williams with a good carry on first down across midfield, down to the 45-yard line for the Bulls. South Florida offense is going to be introduced by senior offensive lineman, Mr. Walter Walker.
The USF offense is led by quarterback Matt Grothy, a great all-around character guy. He's a great arm. He's a great leader. Up front, we have the offensive line, the mean green machine, here to grind them up all night.
19 yards on that gain by Ben Williams. Into Tiger territory. on the first offensive play of the game. This is what we'll see a lot from South Florida. Looking over to the sidelines, coaches calling the plays and reading the defense for Matt Grothy. Williams. And that man, Quentin Groves, has got him, knocks his hat off. Loss on the play of about three. Well, offense of the defense for the Auburn Tigers. Keep your eye on that man, number 54, Quentin Groves. He's the sack master. At linebacker, Trey Blackman's bad ankle is good to go. But at free safety, Eric Brock steps in for the injured Aaron Savage. Will Muschamp is the coordinator for the Tiger D, and he has to like that play.
And they're going to be looking for 54 Groves all night, so Sen'Derrick Marks on the other side should take advantage of that.
Five wide receivers for Grothy on second and long. And he throws behind his receiver, Jesse Hester Jr. Incomplete.
Now, every play is reviewed. He says he caught the ball. So they're looking at it right now up in the booth.
Now, this is an SEC crew.
Called an incompletion. See if his left hand gets under the ball. No, it bounced. It bounced.
Third down for the Bulls. They were 7 of 15 on third down against Elon last week. Clock running down. Third and 13. Blitz coming. Grothy gets it off to Hester. And Hester gets wrapped up and taken down short of the 40-yard line. Jonathan Wilhite with a solid tackle there.
He hesitated. He could have beaten him to the sideline and maybe made that cut to the sticks. But if you watch after the catch, he hesitates just a second. And Auburn defensively is so fast, you're not going to have them overrun the play. They come under control, they break down, they make the play. Will Hite with a nice play.
This is Delbert Alvarado, the place kicker, back in punt formation for Justin Tichy, the normal punter. Ball bounces, and it's going to be down on the one-yard line.
Oh, what a great, great play by Trey Williams, showing that speed, outside contain, and getting down to the goal line to make that stop of the football before it went into the end zone for a touchback. Just watch how he runs right by the receiver. There's 21, Trey Williams at the goal line. Outstanding special teams play.
And a tough place for the Auburn Tigers to start their first possession, and this is an offense that has struggled recently.
Especially the offensive line, Dan. They really had trouble stopping anybody last year. And we'll keep an eye on King Dunlap, number 77, because he was one of the culprits at the top of your screen.
That's Carl Stewart in motion. Quick pass out here to Preche Rodriguez, and he gets the ball with some breathing room out to the 7-yard line. Auburn offense will be introduced by Tigers offense coordinator Al Borges.
Our offense tonight will feature senior quarterback Brandon Cox, who has been here for a while. I think he signed in the same class as Bo Jackson. Also, our big left tackle, King Dunlap, who blocks out the sun, and tonight will more likely block out the moon.
Thank you, Al. A little stand-up comedy from the offensive coordinator. Here's Ben Taken, tripped up in the backfield by number 95, George Selvey. The South Florida defense will be introduced by senior linebacker Ben Moffitt.
USF defense led up front by George Selvey. He had 4 sacks last week. The linebackers are going to bring the speed all night. And the secondary is led by cornerback Trey Williams and Mike Jenkins. They'll lock you down all night.
Better lock him down right here. This is third and long.
Three wide receivers for Auburn as they are forced to call a timeout as the play clock running down. You can see the hash marks under the name Auburn and USF. That indicates how many timeouts each team has in the half, and Auburn has burned their first one. But getting back to the problems that this offense has had, Tim, they're not running the ball the way Auburn fans like to see it.
No, the offensive line we've talked about, we've documented that. It's been well documented in the papers and on the talk shows and everywhere else. Really struggled last week. They still came from behind and beat Kansas State 23-13. There's a reason King Dunlap struggled. I mean, he was changing diapers. He had his second child just before the game, so he was changing diapers. Probably should have been wearing one, but he really had a tough night. Then if you look at this, here's the Auburn offense, and this is always big. They score a lot of points. And there's no reason why they won't do it the rest of this season. They just have to get things going and get in sync, and with Brandon Cox, they're able to do that. And keep in mind, Brad Lester's had some academic problems, and he's not playing either.
Third down and six from the 5-yard line. Three wide receivers. This is Cole Bennett in motion. And Cox is tripped and goes down at the 1-yard line.
Tripped over Jason Bosley, his center. His left foot, as it pushed away, got caught under his foot. Watch his feet. Got them both caught under Bosley's feet as Bosley started the block right after the snap.
Not a whole lot of room for the punter for the Tigers. This is Ryan Shoemaker.
Boy, South Florida's fast too, Dan. They may be coming.
They got 9 men coming. Shoemaker gets it out, and it's a good punt out to midfield. This is Trey Williams at the 45-yard line. Marcus Edwards, rather, and he goes out of bounds and gives the Bulls good field position one more time.
You know, this is an opportunity that South Florida had in the first series with good field position. They started at the 35. They got a first down. They moved the chains. Now here it is again. They cannot waste many of these opportunities. They've got to get points on the board, score early, melt the clock, shorten the game, build that success, build that confidence, and they've got a pretty good shot here tonight.
And the big freshman tailback, Mike Ford, is in the I-back position. 3 touchdowns last week in his debut. And he gets the carry left side, and he gets met right away at the line of scrimmage. Gerard Powers from his cornerback spot came in and took down the 225-pound Ford.
Auburn's secondary can be dominant, and although cornerback David Irons is gone, these DBs are shutdown guys. Powers comes off that corner quickly. He was almost in a 9 technique, just coming straight off the edge.
And Pat Sims cut off the cutback lane for Mike Ford.
Auburn is not a big blitz team. They like to get that 4-man rush, but they sure put the pressure, and they come hard from every direction.
Second and long, Grothy's going to run it up the middle and pick up about 3 or 4.
So he got back to the original line of scrimmage, just past it, to bring up third down and long again for Grothy, and that's not what he likes. He's got great feet. He's a great runner. When he's in that backfield, especially out of the shotgun, Dan, you have to account for him like a runner.
There's no question about that.
So the defense counts 2 runners in that backfield.
Led the team in rushing last year as a true freshman. He'll have 4 wide receivers on this third down and 9. Rolling right. Buying time, now going to throw deep. Got Amari Jackson. And it's incomplete. Flag down.
And I think this is going to be on Amari Jackson. He had to come back for the ball, and when he did, he pushed off.
Well, the field judge is Mike Washington. And he had trouble throwing the flag. He threw his beanbag first, and then he threw the flag.
Well, Auburn thinks it's against them. I thought it was against Amari Jackson.
It's against Auburn.
Yep.
You can see they're 15 yards from the previous spot. Our official Steve Shaw.
Pass interference, number 24 on the defense. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
So they called it on Will Height. And Tommy Tuberville, he doesn't like it because he thinks Amari Jackson pushed off. You tell me. Watch 18. Here he comes back for the ball. Well, that's a good call. Will Height never looked back and ran right into Jackson as he was pushing. Jackson was almost protecting himself from Will Height.
First down for the Bulls at the 29-yard line. Option play. Ford across the 30. He's got a lane inside the 20, inside the 15, and out of bounds.
And there's a flag down. What a block on the corner by Marcus Edwards. But they're going to bring it back.
Flag thrown as soon as that ball was snapped.
Southeastern Conference crew, as we told you earlier.
There's no flag on the play. It was unbalanced line. We had 7 men on the line of scrimmage. No flag. First down.
That's good officiating.
Very good. They got together and said, hey, on the other side, they did have enough men on the line of scrimmage. 20 yards on the gain.
Watch this block to the right of your screen by number 11. Bam! Just laid him on the earth. He got two of them. Came after Quentin as well.
And big Mark Dial got out in front, too. That's a good sign for the Bulls. He wasn't feeling too well yesterday. First and goal. Ford, right side. Bouncing off tacklers inside the five, dragging tacklers to the one.
You know, it's amazing. You talk about a good sign. Marcus Edwards is out there throwing blocks. He leveled one guy and chipped at the other. And Edwards is only 5'11", 164 pounds. When you get receivers blocking like that, it opens up everything. Now watch the line. Zone blocking. They go down. Ford goes outside. Now Ford is the recruit that everybody's talking about. He's a true freshman, but he did go to Hargrave Military Academy, went to junior college, was recruited here at Auburn and Alabama.
Scored on the ground twice, caught one in the end zone for three. Here he is here. No, it's Grothy on the fake, and Grothy to the goal line. Touchdown, South Florida.
Look out. South Florida wanted the early score, the success, build the confidence, quiet the crowd, and they've got it.
Happy birthday, Matt Grothy, turning 21 today.
Look at this. The Bulls traveled pretty well. Look at all the green jerseys in the stands. So they're going to review the touchdown.
Yeah, our replay official is James Allison. This is an official review, not a challenge. Just to see if he got across before his knees were down. It was close. Really a good fake, huh?
And then the hole opened up. Nice job by the offensive line. They're looking at his knee there to see if it hit before the ball crossed the line. I don't know if you can really tell by that angle. There's the fake again. Good blocking. Herman gets a block. Walker gets a block.
I think that's a touchdown, Tim.
I wouldn't take it away from him. Is there any indisputable evidence? Here's another look. They might put this thing right there on the goal line.
It would be third down and inches
right
if that's
there.
The case.
Can't tell if his butt's on the line or not, where the football is at that particular time from the angle.
But they scored nine times last year on the ground when he was leading the Bulls in rushing.
Well, he was the Big East freshman of the year. Beat West Virginia. Here it is again.
Well, he's taking on a big guy, too. That's Josh Thompson, 6 foot, 300 pounder.
I'll tell you this, if the ball was in his left hand, there'd be no review right now. But the ball was in his right hand, where it should be if he's running to the right, so that his body can protect it.
I'm not sure there's enough evidence to overturn this one.
I don't think so either. But Matt Grothy had a great visit with him last night. He's a very confident guy, cowboy, gunslinger.
Yeah, it was fun talking to him. He said he was nervous last week against Elon. I asked him, are you nervous tonight going up against the Tigers?
It was a touchdown.
And the answer was no. He's not nervous coming in here to play Auburn because he says we're better than they are.
Yeah, they're on top right now. Gilbert Alvarado, who was perfect last week, 4 for 4. Remember going back to his punt that was down by Trey Williams. That really set up the Bull offense in great field position. And Alvarado was perfect.
The last 2 years, South Florida has won some big, big ball games, Dan. They went down, they beat Louisville. Last year, they went up to Morgantown, they took on number 7 West Virginia and beat the Mountaineers. They come rolling in here 1-0 in front of a huge crowd, the 9th largest stadium in the United States of America, and they say, we're better than they are. That's a little swagger in your step.
And you can see the South Florida fans whooping it up while Auburn fans are saying, hey, this is the second week in a row we've trailed here. Trailed to K-State, needed 2 touchdowns in the last 2 minutes of that game to pull it out.
Matt Grothy leading that touchdown drive. His highlights, as I said earlier, became a huge hit on YouTube last year. He became almost a cult figure. Led USF over West Virginia. Grothy, he was recognized really almost as a luminary down in Florida. But he did have 14 interceptions last year, and that's what he says he needs to correct to get to the next level.
And those 14, of those 14, four of them were in the red zone.
Right.
And those are absolute killers because you come away, obviously, with 0 points.
You speak like you've been there.
Been there, done that, unfortunately, too many times.
Not many times, folks. Dan Fouts is a Hall of Famer, as you know.
Yeah. Despite 242 interceptions.
You got to stop. You're giving way too much information.
Patrick Lee back deep for the Tigers to kick off for the Bulls is Justin Tichy, again from the 30-yard line, and he drills it. 2 yards deep. This is Mario Fannin. Left side, big hole, 30, 35, and out of bounds, 36-yard line. Mario Fannin with his first touch of the 2007 season.
You know, Dan, since they put in the new rule of kicking from the 30, you look at the games last week, and of all the games, the return average is about 5 yards more than it was a year ago. This return out to the 37, and it gives Cox pretty good field position.
It'll be first and 10 from the 37-yard line for the Tigers. And we welcome everyone who's been watching that fine game between South Carolina and Georgia. Here, USF has jumped out on top early in the first quarter, 7-0 over 17th-ranked Auburn. Then Tate on that last carry. Jordan Hare Stadium, 87,451. And what a sight it is.
Ninth largest stadium in the nation, Cox in South Florida. Two good drives. Cox scored on the last one. And they're on the board 7-0.
Second and 6 for Brandon Cox. Pressure, and he throws it away, and it's almost intercepted by George Selvey, the defensive end, dropping off in coverage. A couple of big plays on that last scoring drive for the Bulls. Remember the pass interference against Wilhite. Mike Ford then had a 20-yard run down inside the 5-yard line, and then Grothy took it in from 1 yard out. 3 wide receivers for Brandon Cox. Bunch formation. And now in motion, that's Rodriguez. Cox throws way, way too high for Rodriguez.
Not even close. There was no blitz. They came with a 4-man rush. He had plenty of time to throw, but instead he released it very, very high. It flew out of bounds. Keep in mind now, his off shoulder is all black and blue because he was sacked so many times, 5 times last week, and he was hit countless times. But that shouldn't have affected that throw. He looked like he was throwing pretty well when we were at practice.
This offense continues to struggle. That's their second 3 plays and punt of the first quarter. Ryan Shoemaker is the punter. Back deep is Marcus Edwards, staying all the way back at his 15. And for good reason. This is a beautiful punt inside the 10, back to the 6-yard line. Edwards out to the 35-yard line. Marcus Edwards with a brilliant return of 29 yards.
Everybody blocks on this football team. Everybody.
South Florida Bulls on top, 7-0. College football primetime.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Red Lobster. Come see what's fresh today during Endless Shrimp at Red Lobster. And ESPN Game Plan. See the most college football every Saturday. To order, call your pay-per-view provider. ESPN Game Plan lives here.
This is beautiful Samford Hall. The building was built back in 1888, renovated in 71. It's named for William James Samford, Alabama's 31st governor. And the clock on the tower chimes every 15 minutes. Ruins a good nap. Here's Grothy on the roll. trying to buy time. He's got his receiver, Jackson, on the sidelines, out of bounds at the 45-yard line of Auburn.
Amari Jackson was the guy that really helped out in the scoring drive. Let's go back. We'll take you through the action so far. Amari Jackson runs a pretty good route, but the ball's underthrown, and it is Will Height of Auburn who was called with pass interference. Then Mike Ford took it around for the big gainer, moved the chains inside the 10. Here's the fake by Cox. Or Grothy, rather, and Matt Grothy scores, and that was the winning drive, or the leading drive here in the first quarter, 7-0.
And they're on the move again, 20 yards on the pass play, Grothy to Jackson. Here's a reverse. Torres Johnson gets around Antonio Coleman, but not for much.
You know, it's interesting so far. Jim Leavitt told us that he was going to open the playbook. He was going to throw everything at Auburn. There's nothing to lose. You're coming in this house. Auburn is nationally ranked. We're just going to open this thing up, and we're going to go after it. So far, we've seen pass plays. We've seen play action. We've seen reverses. We've seen, I mean, this is fun football here. These guys are having a ball.
That's Ryan Shoemaker. What's the story on him, Todd?
Well, Fauci, they came off, and he immediately went right to his elbow, right on the bone. The doctors were looking at it, and they were shaking their head. They've applied a lot of ice. They're immobilizing. He's going into the locker room. We'll get more in a moment.
Thank you, Todd Harris. Let's take a look at that injury. You don't usually want your punter making tackles.
Well, he had to. He fought off a block. There's 21, comes in. Looks like he almost hit his arm on the knee.
I think Zach Etheridge, number 4, got him too, right there. That's that old sandwich play, huh?
Well, plus the fact that Edwards hitting pretty hard, you're right, and they aren't used to that. Punters aren't used to that kind of contact.
3rd and 6 for the Bulls. Play clock running down. Grothy under a blitz. Throws high on the crossing route. Almost intercepted.
That wasn't a good pass, and Matt Grothy knows it. He's got to put a little air under that thing, a little bit softer.
Eric Brock almost got that tip.
They say that Grothy is the best leader and playmaker since Markell Blackwell back in 2002. Leavitt loves him.
This is Delbert Alvarado punting it away to Robert Dunn, is standing right on his 10-yard line. And Dunn will let it go, and it will go into the end zone. Good decision by Robert Dunn.
The game goes into the end zone for a touchback. The punt traveled 41 yards.
7:15 to go in the first quarter. USF 7, Auburn nothing. You're watching College Football Primetime.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Mazda, always the soul of a sports car, and NikeFootball.com. Leave nothing.
That's Toomer's Corner, named after Toomer's drugstore at Magnolia and College Street. Rumor has it, and my buddy Keith Jackson tells me, it's the best lemonade in the entire country.
That guy right there that's squeezing him, too, is a dead ringer for Jason Bosley, the center for Auburn.
I doubt they're drinking lemonade there, though. 1st and 10 from the 20. Mario Fanning in the game, and Cox has got it out to Rodriguez. Fine fingertip. Tip catch and out of bounds. 1st down, Auburn. Nate Allen pushed him out there.
Ball still was almost overthrown, but Petre Rodriguez, he's their leading receiver. 6 catches last week. He was actually recruited by South Florida to play basketball. Florida can't afford that, Dan. They can't have negative plays, they can't have penalties, and stay in this ballgame with Auburn. They lead 7-0. They can't just knock it away. Here's Rodriguez, gets out of bounds, and there's the late hit. Not much of one, but they throw the flag on it.
That moves the ball out to the 47-yard line for Auburn. Best field position by far here in the first quarter. Mario Fannin is the tailback behind Carl Stewart, and he gets the ball left side. Breaking tackles across midfield. 1st carry for Mario Fannin.
Now let's check in with Stan Verrett. Stan, how you doing tonight?
All right, Dan, we got the primetime pulse on the ESPN family of networks over on ESPN. It's LSU with the early lead on Virginia Tech. Jason Hester with a touchdown there. And Jeff Gordon leading the Chevy Rock and Roll 400 over on ABC.
Thank you, Stan. Fanning got four on first down. Cox throws, and a fine catch by Rod Smith. Was he inbounds? Yes, he was.
Right in front of Trey Williams, came back, drove him off, and then came back for the football and stayed inbounds. This is well thrown. Good fake. Cox steps up. How about this? Smith comes back for the ball and stayed inbounds. Working on a good corner over there. Trey Williams will play on Sundays. Number 21 just gave too much of a cushion.
First down, 39-yard line of USF.
And Cox is getting into a little bit of a rhythm.
It's getting time to throw. Fannin, left side, flag down. Big hole, left side. This flag was thrown immediately as the ball was snapped.
Let's see what that flag is. But Mario Fannin getting his first carries, and the coaches say he's the next great running back at Auburn. He's a former high school quarterback, extremely quick. This is going against South Florida as well. And the drive continues for the Auburn Tigers.
Second penalty on the drive.
There's
against
a look at
USF,
there.
Yep.
Redshirt freshman. They've tried to bring him along slower, but tonight they want him just to turn it loose. They told him they put some plays in just specifically for him and run like he does in practice.
Did not play against Kansas State because of the unorthodox defense that the Wildcats played last week. They're going to decline that penalty and take the yardage on the play. Cannon picked up eight, so that'll be second down and two instead of first down and five. See how this plays out. Fannin behind Stewart, and he gets it up the middle behind Stewart, and a first down for Auburn. Got hit in the backfield, but spun away from Ben Moffitt to pick up the first down.
But already you can see this Auburn offensive line is playing a lot better than it did last week against Kansas State. Dunlop, Green, Bosley, Berry, Zimba, they're all throwing blocks. Look at them locking on guys and pushing them back, moving the line of scrimmage down near that first down strike. King Dunlap was the only returning senior on that offensive line, number 77. He struggled last week. And then we found out, well, there was a reason for it. He had his second child just before the game.
Might have been just a little tired, huh?
Changing diapers. The way he played looked like he was wearing one.
And one of the diaper dandies, freshman Lee Zimba, rocked back in his stance and gets called for the false start. Zimba, 6'8", 297.
Before the snap, false start, number 73 on the offense, 5-yard penalty. It remains first down.
You know, I'm giving King Dunlap a hard time, and certainly he's one of those guys. He's 6'8", 312
pounds.
Yeah,
you sure you want to do that?
No. He's a heck of a player. He knows he didn't play well. As a matter of fact, coaches got all over him this week in practice, and you can see he heard him loud and clear.
Move it back five, first down, 15 now. Fannin, left side. And the Bulls wrap him up there, but he still picks up two or three. Now let's check in with Stan Verrett. Stan?
All right, Dan, LSU and Virginia Tech over on ESPN. The Tigers wrapping up a 10-play, 87-yard drive. Jacob Hester on the quick hitter for the touchdown. Bayou Bengals up 7-0 and knocking on the door once again.
Fannin got two. 32-yard line now for the second down and 13. Fake to Fannin. Cox with time to throw down the sideline. Double covered and almost intercepted. Coming over is Trey Williams trying to get the ball to Carl Stewart on the wheel route, but Williams would have none of it.
Trey Williams already in the first quarter has made his presence known. He's playing a heck of a football game. If you watch watch him. Number 21 will come in late. There he is. Goes up and almost makes the interception. He's out of bounds. He decided to pass up the lure of the NFL to stay in school and come back. He and Jenkins both have the talent to play in the NFL.
I'm not sure what Cox was seeing there. Tyrone McKenzie had great coverage on Stewart.
With a safety over the top.
Four wide receivers for Cox on third and 13. Time to throw, and almost intercepted again. Jerome Murphy. If he picks that off, Timmy, it's goodbye.
We talked about it at the beginning of the game, Dan. This secondary is definitely the strength of this defense, and they all have speed. They're in a two-deep five under, and Murphy just breaks on the ball and almost has the pick. Bats it away.
So that'll bring on Wes Byram, true freshman from Fort Lauderdale. He's 3-for-4 last week in his debut against Kansas State. This one will test his distance. He missed from 47 last week.
Keep in mind, he replaced John Vaughn, who was a finalist for the Lou Groza Award, Auburn's all-time leading scorer. He's got big shoes to fill.
49-yard attempt. It's straight. It's true.
And the shoe fits.
Sprained ankle and all.
Whole stadium is rocking.
4:19 to go, first period. Auburn's on the board thanks to this Wes Byram 49-yard field goal.
You don't get many opportunities. Everybody's going to be watching. Everybody's going to be looking to see how you're going to make a change from last week. Now, you got a team down there that's pretty dang good. You fix to find out how good they are, but they're going to find out how good you are. Let's go take it to them.
The Tigers.
I want to thank Tommy Tuberville for letting us eavesdrop in the Tiger locker room. You're getting fired up, didn't you, Timmy?
Yeah, no question. I like him a lot. You know, Auburn has won 34 games over the last three seasons under Tommy Tuberville. That's four more than Florida, two more than LSU, and three more than Ohio State. Tommy Tuberville does a heck of a job.
And his team is on the board. Zach Kutch will kick it off. This will go to Jerome Murphy. And he's got a good return going out to the 25. Struggling across the 30-yard line. Another fine return by Jerome Murphy. Now get your weekly dose of NFL news and analysis as Chris Berman hosts ESPN's Emmy-winning pregame show Sunday, NFL Countdown. Wendy Nix will interview Jets head coach Eric Mangini. And then the NFL's new touchdown king will open his home to the league's all-time leading rusher. Emmitt Smith will find out how LaDainian Tomlinson finds the motivation he needs to top his amazing season of 06. Sunday, NFL Countdown presented by IBM on ESPN at 11 Eastern. 31-yard line for the Bulls. Here's Mike Ford bouncing to the outside. First down, Bulls out of bounds. Eric Brock knocks him out there, but this guy is a load, 13 yards.
He's a terrific story, too. We briefly told you about 26. He was recruited by Alabama, recruited by Auburn. They wanted him here. He almost signed at Alabama, but was a non-qualifier academically. But he went to Hargrave Military Academy. Then he went to JUCO. He's worked his way back up. Here he is. He's got four carries, 39 yards tonight, and he's getting the attention of everybody.
Grothy fakes to him. And throws the ball, and it's almost intercepted by Eric Brock. Remember, Brock is filling in for Aaron Savage, who injured his ankle last week against K-State. Brock doing a good job.
And we'll keep an eye on that, too, because Aaron Savage, who's out with that ankle injury, he's the quarterback of the secondary. He makes all the calls. He gets them lined up, calls the in and outs, and Auburn likes to use a lot of cover one man with a robber, so we'll see if he makes all the calls here. Brock doing a good job so far.
He's looking for the signal from the sidelines. Here's Ford, right side for a couple.
Mike Ford brought down by number 54.
Bulls chilling on the sidelines. It's just a beautiful night here on the plains. Big third down now for the South Florida Bulls.
That's impressive, huh?
Against this defense, you bet it is. Throw three to Johnson. One-handed catch by Torres Johnson.
Are you
kidding
me?
Whoa, what a catch.
Are you kidding me? Right between Powers and Brock. Torres Johnson, their leading receiver. When you ask the coaches about him, they just say he's a playmaker. Well, I guarantee you, look at this. Like he's making a baseball catch in deep center field. Here's Brock, 33 in Powers. But you don't get any better than this. That's Sports Center material right there.
Yeah, on third and eight, they pick up 23. Here's Grothy with a fake. Cuts back inside the 20, 15, 10. Grothy down inside the five-yard line. He juked Zach Etheridge. What a move by those quick feet for 27 yards.
And watch the read. There's the fake. Now look at this. As you look at that here, look at all the running room he's got. He sees it. He goes. And then this is a stop on a dime, give you 9 cents change and see you later. Takes it all the way down inside the 10. Matt Grothy is really talented. Led the team in rushing last year.
They've gained 50 yards in the last two plays. Here's Grothy. And the ball is complete to Ben Busby, but it's thrown low, and Busby has to go down, secure the catch, and cannot get into the end zone. He was wide open.
Matt Grothy was a little bit winded on that play. You could tell he's still sucking air. See him breathing hard. See the shoulders going up and down like a fighter late in the rounds. He had to reload that pass. Most of the time, if you reload, you're in trouble.
Ball marked just inside the 2-yard line. Three running backs. This is Mike Ford, right side. And Ford is in the end zone. Touchdown, Bulls.
Wow.
That was an impressive drive by South Florida.
All highlighted by Torres Johnson's catch.
And Grothy's run. Delbert Alvarado adds the 14th point. 69 yards in 7 plays. Mike Ford, this is no Edsel. Bull fans whooping it up here at Auburn. On top by 11 as we near the end of the first quarter. Jim Leavitt's got to be thrilled with this start. Here's Alvarado's kick. And this is Patrick Lee at about the 11. And Lee just refuses to go down or out of bounds. Gets all the way across the 35-yard line.
South Florida's a great story. Look at this. Football team was approved by the school back in 1995. Jim Leavitt was hired as the head coach. He was washing all the uniforms at the time. 1996, they had the first football practice. 97, first game. 80-3 win over Kentucky Westland. 2005, the first Big East game played. And then last year, they went to their first bowl game and won that 24-7 over East Carolina. So, I mean, this is just a great, remarkable story of tenacity. And how about Jim Leavitt? Wash the uniforms. Great story.
Here's Cox outside to Chris Slaughter. And a late flag. It'll be roughing the passer. And it appears that it was Robert Kleber.
Kleber, too, is having some words afterwards. I think he's apologizing. Actually, McKenzie was the 127 that hurt him in the back.
Personal foul. Roughing the passer, number 76 on the defense, 15 yards from the end of the line, first and 10.
And they get Cleveland right out of the ballgame, too.
And he really wasn't all that guilty, was he? It was a good, clean shot by McKenzie, just pushed him into Cleveland.
First at Auburn, at the 46.
Here's Fannin, right side, knocking over his own man across the 40-yard line. Get out of my way, Antoine Daniels, number 70.
Daniels is 287 pounds, and Fannin just threw him out of the way. And Daniels is hurt. He's dragging that left arm.
6'5", 287-pound junior from Forsyth, Georgia.
Fannin's 219, and he had the momentum, but right now he's wearing a lampshade, and it's a dim light.
Been there, huh?
Yes, I have. Tonight, for instance.
Gain of 7 on that play. Fannin, again in the eye back behind Stewart. He's got it right side again. He's got the first down now. Mario Fannin showing the promise that these fans have been looking for. Todd, Brandon Cox was sacked 5 times last week against Kansas State. He got beat up a little bit on that last hit, huh?
Yeah, no question about it, Dan. This running game and the success therein is perfect for the health of Brandon Cox. As you guys put it out, 34 times last year, 5 times last week. And you gotta remember, two true freshmen are guarding his blind side. Now, he said last week, he told me, he said, you know, I gotta be honest with you, I was a little foggy in the second half, don't remember everything. But Al Borges says, this guy is so underappreciated, he gave a John Wayne-type performance. He said if the Duke played like Brandon Cox, he probably would have got an Oscar.
Thank you, Pilgrim. This is Rodriguez in motion, and it appeared that there was movement along the offensive line. George Selvey jumped across when he saw that movement.
This is one of those deals where each side is pointing at the other. But to follow up on Brandon Cox, he is one tough guy. He showed us a huge bruise on his left arm. And this is against Auburn.
Gabe top McKenzie.
Of the, yeah, top that of the screen, little flinch. Little flinch, yeah. That's Zimba.
Auburn will use 3 very quality tight ends, Cole Bennett, Gabe McKenzie, and Tommy Trott. So far tonight, they've been just going with the I formation. Stewart at fullback and Fannin behind him in the I formation. Here's Rodriguez in motion. Give to Fannin, and he's hit in the backfield by Tyrone McKenzie.
You know, Tyrone McKenzie right there, 27, started at Michigan State. Then we saw him at Iowa State last year. He transferred, and he's playing here this year. Got an NCAA waiver because of his mom, but that's a big-time play as the quarter ends.
And McKenzie, the leading tackler for the Bulls. 1 quarter is in the books. Nova flying high. University of South Florida 14, the Auburn Tigers 3. You're watching ESPN Primetime. This is available on ESPN2, presented by Pioneer Kuro HD TV. Beautiful pictures provided by our director, Brad Sheldon, our producer, Emmy Award-winning Chris Pfeiffer, and our outstanding crew having a good time here in Auburn. Second and real long for Brandon Cox. Rodriguez is in motion. Cox setting up a screen. Stewart. First down, Auburn. Stewart all the way inside the 10-yard line. King Dunlap with a huge block.
King Dunlap's playing well, but everybody's playing well. If you play Auburn, you better get ready for Al Borges, the offensive coordinator, and his screens. Look at the offensive lineman get out in front. Look at King Dunlap kick out on Williams. That's terrific balance, too, when you talk about a running back, Stewart, who's 230 pounds. That was perfectly set up, perfectly designed, and perfectly executed.
30 yards down to the 8-yard line. Here's Fannin with a full speed ahead across the 5. We're seeing a couple of exciting young running backs for Auburn. It's Mario Fannin, Mike Ford for South Florida. Not really showing us that they're freshmen, are they?
Well, Carl Stewart had him after that screen pass and what he did. He's now at fullback.
Second and goal, Fannin. Touchdown, Auburn. Mario Fannin.
Auburn loaded up, elephant formation. Carl Stewart moved over to the fullback spot in front of Fannin, led him up there, and Fannin just made a good cut, strong move to the goal line.
Both those freshmen have scored touchdowns tonight. Wes Byram will come on, try to give the Tigers their 10th point. And he does.
Downhill running for the Auburn Tigers. Kind of familiar, isn't it? Mario Fannin gets it in the end zone, 14-10 South Florida.
Tommy Tuberville's goal coming in. The offensive line is performing. Fannin is performing. This team looks solid right now. But they still trail South Florida.
Zach Kutch, number one, will kick it off. Jerome Murphy and Taurus Johnson deep for the Bulls. And he pooches it to the front line. It's going to hit the ground in front of Murphy. Johnson, rather, across the 30, 35-yard line. Heck of a play by Taurus Johnson, picking that ball up on one hop. Now time now to check in with Stan Verrett. Stan?
All right, Dan, this Taco Bell studio update takes us to Austin, number 19, Texas. Number 19, TCU, rather. Number 7, Texas, Colton McCoy scrambling to the 1. Vondrell McGee would punch it in from there, and the Horns up 17-10 now on the Horned Frogs.
Thank you, Stan.
Colton McCoy, one of the guys I think should be looked at heavily this year. He's a key player for them.
This is Mike Ford trying to find room back across the middle. Time now for this week's Aflac trivia question. Quentin Groves is one sack away from tying Auburn's all-time sack record. Who holds that record?
I know.
That doesn't surprise me that you would know that, being a defensive-minded fella as you are.
Did a couple of his games. I don't know if that's good or bad.
Didn't hurt him any. Groves has held sackless so far tonight. Four wide receivers for Grothy on second and long. Carlton Mitchell, the speedster, for the short game.
And Grothy's getting very comfortable. He looked off his receiver, faked it to the right, comes back to Mitchell to the left side. Mitchell, of course, their fastest player, so they want to isolate him and get him in space. But Grothy, you can see, is very comfortable right now on this field.
And he deals it around to a lot of receivers. That's very impressive. 10 different receivers last week. This is Benjamin Williams. Barely getting across the 40-yard line and back to the line of scrimmage. Chris Evans, middle linebacker. He's playing in the place of Trey Blackman, who sprained his ankle last week against Kansas State when he intercepted a pass at the end of the first half.
Good containment, good follow. They're all going down the line. They're just scraping off, getting down the lane, inside out, and playing it well. You get 9 guys. You know, half of playing defense is wanting to. It's effort. Great effort by Auburn on that play.
Check out this spread formation for Delbert Alvarado. This is Robert Dunn. Fine return by Dunn across the 25-yard line. 40-yard punt by Alvarado. And Dunn brought it back 10 yards. So Auburn and Brandon Cox will try to get back on the scoreboard when we come back.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Mitsubishi Motors, driven to thrill, and Aflac. Ask about it at work.
That's Nova with a flyby before the kickoff tonight.
War Eagle. Great scene here in Auburn.
First and 10. Ben Tate. Good gain. First down and more. Mike Jenkins brings him down.
talked about this offensive line. It all starts with them. You could talk about tape, but watch this play develop. Look at this block it right here. I mean, he's got a running lane that he can just turn loose now. Great running, great kick-out block. Tate makes a move, and then it's just a foot race. But Tate is a sophomore. Last year as a freshman, he was third on the depth chart. He led the Tigers in yards per carry, 7 yards a run. So even though last year he didn't carry it that much, every time he carried it, he got big yardage. And again this year, if you look at this number right here, that is what it's all about.
Got 36 on that carry. Showed great balance. But there's no mystery to this Auburn offense tonight, is there? Al Borges has just gone back to plan A, and that's Auburn football running downhill at his opponent.
They challenged the offensive line in practice, and the offensive line is responding, and the running backs like that right there with Tate are running with authority.
They only gained 62 yards on the ground last week against Kansas State. Tonight, 71, and we've got a whole bunch of time left here in the first half.
Well, they were embarrassed last week. They couldn't get anything going. Tommy Tuberville and the offensive line coaches, Al Borges, the offensive coordinator, they were really upset. So they challenged the guys this week, and so far they're responding.
That's the slim down Al Borges. He's dropped 43 pounds. That's Tommy Trott in motion. Fake to Tate. Cox in trouble. And he throws, and it's almost intercepted. Ryan Gilliam won't have an easier chance at an interception than that one.
That's a poor throw from a very experienced quarterback, and he knows it. Watch this now. He'll step up, and he almost just ducks as he throws it. He's not looking where he throws it. Didn't care where it went. He thought it was going out of bounds, but it was should have been picked off. You know, he's not only the oldest player on the Auburn roster, he's older than 18 quarterbacks on NFL rosters. He'll be 24 October 31st. He's experienced, time-tested. He shouldn't make that throw.
He's 0 for 3 on third downs, third and 10 here. Throwing deep down the middle. Got a receiver and just too far for Robert Dunn. Dunn had a touchdown, ball thrown too far.
And again, that is on Cox. Your receiver works hard to get open, and number three makes a nice move on the safety, and Dunn is wide open there, and the ball is way out in front of him. Cox has to put that thing up in the air a little bit more, let him run under it, but you cannot overthrow that ball when a guy works that hard to get open. Dunn was wide open. It should have been six.
That's Patrick Tatum back to punt for Auburn. Remember, Ryan Shoemaker was injured in the first quarter. This is Tatum's first punt. Kicks it away from Marcus Edwards, and that ball is absolutely perfect. Gerard Powers downs it at the one-yard line.
We said at the beginning of the game, Dan, the outcome will be determined by the kicking game. And we've already seen the ball down on the one by South Florida. Now we see the ball down on the one by Auburn, and we'll see how the Bulls react now with their backs to the wall.
Not a bad first punt. This is where the crowd can really get involved. You can see Grothy will take the snap from under center with his feet in his own end zone. Jamar Taylor with his first carry gets it out to the 4-yard line. Well, earlier we asked you the Aflac trivia question. Quentin Groves is one sack away from tying Auburn's all-time sack record. Who holds the record?
Joe Robinson.
You betcha.
Back in the 1980s. 26 sacks. Quentin Groves, two away from that.
Taylor again. And he spins away from tacklers out to the 5-yard line. Heck of an effort by another freshman. Jamar Taylor, the 6'5", 205-pounder from Lakeland, Florida.
Both of those plays have been terrific efforts. First one I thought was going to be a quarterback sneak. Instead, he went back into the end zone. It was almost a safety. And here's the spin by Taylor to get out to the 5. But at least now, Grothy has a little bit of room where they're able to throw.
Impossible to call an audible here, though, with this crowd noise. Taylor takes it up the middle, and he won't get much.
Good call, Dan. He's 20 yards from the fans there in the back of the end zone. They're just trying to be safe. And again, Jim Leavitt is now relying on the kicking game. But Auburn is going to have terrific field position to start this series. Here they're just trying to take it right up the middle, get a few extra yards.
Great closing, speed by Groves that time. He played down the line of scrimmage. This is Delbert Alvarado, 9 yards deep in his own end zone. This is a tail dragger out to Robert Dunn at midfield. Breaking a tackle down to the 43-yard line. Robert Dunn with a good solid catch and a good return. That is a dangerous looking formation for a punt, don't you think, Tim?
Well, they're trying to spread out the pressure. They're trying to spread out the speed. They've got their little guys there in the gut, the three guys to take care of anybody coming up the middle, and they had the wingmen. But outside of that, they're just trying to spread it out, make it a bigger distance for the speed guys to get there to the punter.
Great field position to start this drive for the Tigers. Cox will throw on first down, and he's going deep to Rodriguez, incomplete inside the 5-yard line. Trishe Rodriguez couldn't bring it in.
Dan, where do you go after a cover two? Right down the middle. And that ball was well thrown. Hit him in a soft spot between the safeties. And look at this ball, right in the breadbasket. That is very rare that you see Trishe Rodriguez drop something like that.
I think he was looking to the end zone and did not see Tyler Roberts come across and just pop that ball out.
Might have been reading headlines, but whatever he was looking at, it wasn't the football. Went right through his hands into his stomach.
Good throw by Brandon Cox, right on the money. Here's Tate. Right at the Bulls inside the 20-yard line. Ben Tate. 24 yards on that tote.
Can't give this offensive line enough credit. You're going to block in here. You're going to block in here. Set up the linebacker and let Tate do his own business. Watch them go here. Little trap. Little misdirection, then cut back, and Tate had the big gainer.
It's time. Tate is met in the backfield by George Selvey. Selvey had a huge game last week against Elon with 4 sacks. Makes a tackle for a loss there.
You know, when you look at this offensive line and how they're working tonight, look at this. Auburn's offensive line, 305 pounds, working against South Florida's defensive line, which is undermanned. So to make the adjustment, South Florida is stemming, they're moving, they're trying to get on the edge, use their speed against that oversize.
4-yard loss that time for the Tigers. Cox avoids pressure, throws high to Rodriguez out of the back of the end zone. Good job of moving in the pocket, but his throw was just a touch high.
South Florida is extremely athletic defensively. Don't be fooled by the school that has a South in its name. I mean, everybody's getting after it up front. Look at this coverage. They're all over Rodriguez. I'm not sure a good throw would have gotten in there that time, Dan.
Tight coverage, no question. Cox has missed his last 4 throws. Down the middle to Trott, and it's intercepted. Intercepted by Nate Allen, his 2nd in 2 games. And it looked like Cox just put that one up for grabs.
Not a calculated move, though, to bring it out of the end zone. But watch Cox throw on the wrong foot here. He's throwing off his back foot and backing up and off balance and out of rhythm. And then here's the interception. And Allen should take a knee right there. He looks upfield. Blue shirts are coming. And instead of being on the 20, with a touchback, he's at the 11.
7.5 minutes to go in the first half. South Florida on top by 4.
The 25 greatest players in college football history, presented by IBM. Coming in 1 week. IBM, getting it done.
Top
25 greatest players in college football is voted on by a Blue Ribbon panel of former coaches and players and media members. We'll reveal 25 through number one over the course of this season, announcing the greatest player in college football in the last week of the regular season. And this is Mike Ford, the freshman for USF.
You know, Brandon Cox is 20-5 as a starter, which is the best in the SEC. So you don't want to get on him too heavily because he's got great success. But this one, he throws back and away. And as you said during the timeout, he's tired of getting hit. But he also throws into coverage. If you look back here from the end zone, look at this. White jerseys everywhere. So Allen was just reading it, picked it off at its highest point, and made the interception.
Here's Mike Ford. Helmets go flying. And in his defense, though, Timmy, as a former quarterback, has thrown a lot of interceptions. But given his receiver, Tommy Trott at 6'5", he tried to put that ball up high and let Trott try to outleap the defenders.
I understand, but as a defensive player, I like that. You know, come on, bring it to me, put it up for grabs, let me have as much right to it as the receiver. And besides that, the first turnover of the night took away a field goal opportunity for Auburn.
And that field goal would have been about a 40-yarder. Byram's already hit a 49-yarder in the first quarter. Grothy, under pressure, gets it out to Busby. And Busby will get the first down for the Bulls. Fine effort by Ben Busby. First catch of the season.
Dan, how about this South Florida team? I mean, look at this zone blocking, play action, roll the other way. They throw before Groves can get to him. And Groves is coming after him a lot tonight, too. But, I mean, they've got speed, and they've got moxie.
Johnson, Jackson, and Edwards, the three wide receivers, movement before the ball was snapped.
Before the snap, false start, number 75 on the offense. Five-yard penalty remains first down.
That's the young man who gave us their starting lineups for the Bulls tonight, Walter Walker, the senior from Fort Lauderdale.
He was all clammy after taping those lineups. He was all nervous.
Not quite as nervous as Ben Moffitt was, though. It took him 35 takes, I think. But we appreciate it. First and 15 for Grothy. Quick screen outside to Taurus Johnson. And a fine tackle there by Eric Brock.
Brock came in a hurry, too. As soon as he read it, he broke on the football and chased him down from behind. And Johnson's fast. So this is a lot for Brock to catch him, but there's 33, and he lays out. Well, he doesn't want Johnson to get ahead of steam.
Looked like he almost popped the ball loose out of Johnson's hand. Second and 14. Again, three wide receivers. Grothy in trouble. Real trouble. More trouble. Down he goes inside the four. Antonio Coleman, number 52, with the tackle. Now let's check in with Stan Verrett. Stan?
All right, guys. Virginia Tech is in serious trouble in Baton Rouge. LSU already up 17-0. Matt Flynn on the option. Keelan Williams hopping over defenders and then turning on the speed 67 yards for the sophomore tailback. And LSU up 24-0 right now on Virginia Tech.
Auburn comes in with five defensive backs. Grothy lost 12 on that play. And he'll give it to Benjamin Williams. Concession call there to give the punter a little bit of room on fourth down coming up.
Well, they don't want to make a mistake. They don't want to give anything easy to Auburn. And so they were very conservative through their play calling. But this defense now for Auburn is starting to feel its oats. I think they've really found their groove. Will Muschamp, the defensive coordinator, is playing two deep, five under. So they're taking some of that speed away from South Florida.
Again, Delbert Alvarado will be 9 yards deep in his own end zone to punt this ball away to Robert Dunn, who's standing at the 45-yard line.
Again, they spread him out.
And this is a bomb by Alvarado. Backs up Dunn inside the 40. He's got a wall and a big block. Dunn inside the 40.
War Eagle on that block.
44 yards on the return after the 54-yard bomb by Alvarado.
You've heard that term, slobber knocker, top of your screen. Bam! Tuck that tail, sky your eyes, and I'm telling you, Andrew Ketchell doesn't know who hit him. McFadden hit him. Number six, where is he? Take another look. How about that block?
No fillings left on that hit. First and 10 again. Great field position for Auburn. This is Fannin. And the Bulls wrap him up after a short gain. Well, Monday Night Football returns to the ESPN with a doubleheader. First at 7 Eastern, it's Willis McGahee leading the Baltimore Ravens offense into Cincinnati to take on Carson Palmer. Then at 10:15 Eastern, Matt Leinart and the Arizona Cardinals face the San Francisco 49ers. Don't miss the return of Monday Night Football with a doubleheader on ESPN.
Chad Johnson says he's going back to the celebrations. He's going to have fun, serious fun. He's going to be rocking the baby.
Cox on the play fake, gets it outside. Montez Billings with his first catch of the season.
This has been a very up-tempo, intense first half. And lost in it all is the fact that USF is still leading Auburn here at home 14-10.
Auburn missed a golden opportunity last time they had the ball with the interception in the end zone. Gain of six that time for Fannin. Cox to throw. To Dunn. Incomplete. Almost intercepted. Fine play by Jerome Murphy. Got a hand on it before the ball got to the receiver.
And then a great play by Trey Williams. The ball was still in the air and he knocked him away from the football.
Oh, these are some very quick defensive backs for both these teams. What a play by Murphy here.
Okay, there's Murph. There's the touch. And see, the ball was still up for grabs and a nice play by Williams just to knock him away and knock him out of bounds. Watch Murphy first, gets a hand on it. Very athletic. Now watch 21 just knock him away, take any chance of catching that football out of play.
Now with 2:34 to go in the half, this is a fourth down attempt. Fourth and four for the Tigers. And now timeout called by South Florida. That's a heads-up timeout call, I think, by Jim Leavitt and the Bulls.
You know, Brandon Cox started this game looking so comfortable, but now he looks so out of sorts. He's been under a lot of pressure. This one he kind of threw up for grabs, almost picked by Williams. There's the one knocked away by Murphy. His secondary by South Florida is very, very quick, but I don't think that surprised him. And then there's the interception by Nate Allen. He's not throwing and stepping into the football. He's backing away when he throws it. Doesn't look sure of himself, but he's out of rhythm. He's not throwing in time. He's been hit five times, hurried three others. Still hasn't been sacked like he was last week five times. But right now, he still doesn't look comfortable.
And the most telling play in the first half that I thought was when he threw a pass and ducked. Boy, defense just loves to see a quarterback ducking.
When you've got a quarterback with his head on a swivel and he's ducking it like a turtle, then you know you've got him uncomfortable.
That's pretty good. We got the ducks and the terrapins all in one sentence there, buddy.
Thank you. I didn't think you'd notice. I'm just testing you. Make sure you're listening.
I listen to every word that comes out of your turtle mouth. Big fourth down play for Brandon Cox and the Tigers. This is well within field goal range for Wes Byram. Remember that 49-yarder he made easily in the first quarter. This play really bothers me as a former quarterback.
Yeah, look at him. I mean, he didn't look where he threw it.
That ball was almost picked.
And his head went down in a hurry. He was just bracing to get hit. And at that point, to be honest with you, you're a defender. Now you're really trying to tee off on him. He's really defenseless.
All right, you're a defensive guy.
Sure.
What are you expecting from Auburn on this play if you're the middle linebacker?
Well, the first thing I want to make sure of that there's containment because they've hurt us on the wing. Then the middle linebacker, he's got to be watching
Please
for that power play.
Reset the clock to 2 minutes, 34 seconds.
They've run a little trap in there with Bosley and Green. It's had some success. And Fannin is a power back. And the one play where they put Stewart in front of Fannin, I don't know. We'll see how they line up here. But you got to be aware of the trap, and you got to have containment. Make sure the safeties are playing like Banjo, cheating up for the run, because right now Cox is very uncomfortable.
Two tight ends in the game, Trott and Bennett. That's Dunn in motion. Fannin in the backfield with Cox. Cox to throw. And he's got Dunn. First down, Auburn.
So how'd I do? I'm expecting the run because Cox is so out of sorts. But Borges very wisely gives him a high percentage out pattern, which is one of the safest plays you can throw. You get out of all that congestion in the middle. You throw out where you can see the coverage, and he hits Dunn. And they move the chains.
And he threw in rhythm. Got back quickly. Got the ball on target. First down, Auburn.
Good job by Al Borges, the offensive coordinator.
Here's Fannin right side behind Stewart. Good block by Stewart. Fannin flagged down. They'll get the wide receiver, Rodriguez, I think, with an illegal block on the perimeter.
You see 15 there at the top, not even disguising the hole. Rodriguez just had both hands on him and was pulling him.
If you're going to hold somebody, you better hold Tyrone McKenzie. He's the leading tackler for the Bulls.
There were two fouls on the play. Holding, number 66 on the offense. Face mask, number 27 on the defense. They all set. We'll replay first down.
Well, our apologies to Pre-Shea Rodriguez. He was getting his face mask grabbed while Mike Berry was holding up front.
Take another look at it.
First and 10 at the 23.
That's the right hand of Tyrone McKenzie.
That's a good angle, too. We couldn't see it from the other side.
So we'll start over. Inside of 1 minute. Flag down. Fannin left side. We'll see what this penalty is all about.
That was a good old-fashioned power blast there. Counter Trey brought the guard and tackle around in front of him from the other side.
George Selvey lining up offsides. Selvey's been held in check tonight by King Dunlap.
Offsides, number 95 on the defense. 5-yard penalty from the previous spot. Repeat first down.
King Dunlap doing a great job, 6'8", 312 pounds, senior. They got after him in practice this week because of his performance last week. Didn't grade out well, and he has really come to play tonight.
Cox throwing too high for Mario Fannin on the screen pass. Let's check in one more time with Stan Verrett. Stan?
All right, Dan, Jesse Palmer is going to join me at the half, and we've got a Bayou beatdown going on in Baton Rouge, Jesse.
Tell you what, Matt Flynn's ability right now, the creativity, his running ability, and the opportunity to run option, you've seen all that in the first half so far here for LSU.
Got an update on LSU and Virginia Tech coming up, plus bad to worse for Notre Dame and Michigan in a three-overtime thriller from the Big 12, all coming up at the half.
All right, thanks, fellas. Second down and 5 now. Here's Fannin, wide side, blockers in front. First down, Auburn. Fannin inside the 5, all the way to the 2-yard line. Robert Dunn with a key block on the perimeter.
These guys are all coming this way to block. Now watch what happens. They all block down, counter Trey, get the offensive lineman out there, and Fannin is a load. Actually outran his blockers, but broke the tackle down inside the 5.
Fannin in the eye back position behind Stewart. He gets it left side, and he's met right in the hole. Bruce Mompremier with a big hit there, number 53.
Don't want to canonize Fannin yet, but what a debut. Auburn's had some great running backs, Bo Jackson, Cornell Williams, Rudy Johnson, Joe Cribbs. Go all the way back to Stephen Davis and Kenny Irons, but I'll tell you something. They say this guy is as good as any of them, and he's having a great night here.
Remember, Brad Lester has been suspended for academic reasons. Fannin will take a blow on the sidelines. Ben Tate in now at the tailback spot. Fake to Tate. Flag down. to the end zone. Wide open is Gabe McKenzie. Touchdown. But let's check out the flag. Auburn appeared.
Offsides. Number 95.
George Selby.
Touchdown.
Offsides. Touchdown, Auburn.
Another good call by Al Borges. Let the South Florida defense run its way out and threw back behind it.
Well, when you're running the ball as well as Auburn is running the ball, the play action is just a killer for the defense. Another penalty against the Bulls.
Jim Leavitt's watching this game get away from him here.
Yeah, they're getting manhandled up front. Not a whole lot of coaching you can do about that, is there?
We sat and we watched that tape. And this is not the same offensive line for Auburn we saw against Kansas State. They have a wake-up call. And they've responded.
Well, you go back to that 24-yard punt return by Dunn.
Violation on the defense, 12 men in the formation. Penalty will be declined. Try the point.
Dunn set up Cox with great field position. Remember, they converted on a fourth down and four as well.
South Florida with 12 men. That was the penalty.
This is Wes Byram. And he increases the first lead of the game for the Auburn Tigers.
Well, everything on that call was set up for speed. Everybody's going to go right except for this guy who's going to sneak to the back of the end zone. And that's McKenzie. And nobody picks him up, and he's wide open. And Cox just kind of floats it out to it.
That's the second week in a row that McKenzie has given the Tigers the lead in the ball game. Got the winning touchdown pass against K-State last week. That's his third touchdown reception in his career for the Tigers.
Auburn is best on the move, play action and screens, and Cox looks so much more comfortable when he rolls like that on a waggle.
And he gets away from a lot of that pressure in that pocket. And South Florida's just got to be wondering, how are we going to stop Mario Fannin?
8 plays, 37 yards, 3.5 minutes, and it was dominant.
Now get your weekly dose of NFL news and analysis as Chris Berman hosts ESPN's Emmy-winning pregame show, Sunday NFL Countdown. Eric Mangini turns last year's Jets into a playoff team. What's he going to do for an encore this year? Then the NFL's new touchdown king, LaDainian Tomlinson, opens his home to the all-time leading rusher, Emmitt Smith. Find out how LT will find the motivation he needs to top that great season of last year. That's Sunday NFL Countdown, presented by IBM on ESPN at 11 a.m. Eastern.
Dan, with 29 seconds left in the half, Tommy Tuberville knows his guys have to stay in their lanes. They can't have a letdown here because there's no time left. They've got to stay in their lanes. They've got to cover this kick. And again, you've got to respect the speed of South Florida.
And that speed is Jerome Murphy and Taurus Johnson. There's Johnson. Zach Kutch will kick it away. And he's going to pooch it. And Johnson comes all the way up to the 26-yard line, makes a move and gets out across the 35-yard line. That's a heads-up play by Taurus Johnson.
And the first quarter of this game and the second quarter, dramatically different for South Florida. The Bulls came out. They dominated early on. Look at this. Look at this quarter, 15 yards for South Florida. At 161 total, so they were very effective in the first quarter. Second quarter, the defense of Auburn just shut them down.
And if you look at the little yellow lines under the USF, you'll see that indicates the Bulls have two timeouts, but only 24 seconds to go in the first half. Here's Mike Ford. Looks like Jim Leavitt's content to go into the locker room and not press the issue here.
No, that's a good call. 17-14, you're on the road, you're playing Auburn, you're an underdog, let's get to the house.
And they did call a timeout, though, so they got 15 seconds to go.
That's their second timeout of the half. This will be a 30-second timeout.
Remember, if you're thinking about a field goal for the Bulls, Delbert Alvarado's got a big leg. Last year, he kicked a 56-yarder against Syracuse. So in order to get to that, the Bulls need to pick up about 20 yards and save that last time out.
Pretty good numbers, as long as 56, you just said. But now it's up to Matt Grothy, see if he can make something happen. If they call timeout, then they're trying to score. They're trying to get down there. Let's see. Torius Johnson, if I'm on defense, I'm locating 89 right now.
Mike Ford's got the ball, and he's going to get to the 45-yard line.
I don't know why they took a timeout to have a running play.
Now that running play will run the clock out. Jim Leavitt encouraging his troops, and the Auburn fans have something to cheer about as they go to halftime. Todd Harris is with Coach Tuberville. Todd?
Thank you, Dan. Coach, after a slow offensive start in the first quarter, you really got things going in the second quarter. What was the difference?
Well, the first thing, our defense started getting us the ball back. We didn't tackle very well on defense, and obviously we didn't make any first downs. But, you know, Mario Fannin made a difference for us, running him up inside. It kind of opened up the outside. They were having to leave their linebackers inside. We'll be fine. We'll probably go out and throw the ball a little bit more the second half. They're going to jam the middle up.
Your assessment of your quarterback and your offensive line this week as opposed to last week?
We've gotten a lot better, moving the ball a little bit more consistent, playing a little bit better on third down. But, yeah, we're still not hitting on all cylinders.
Thanks for your time, Coach. Dan?
All right, thanks, Todd. Thank you, Coach. Our halftime score, South Florida trailing by 3, 17-14, the 17th-ranked Auburn Tigers on top. Now let's join Stan and Jesse back in the studio. Fellas?
Ladies and gentlemen.
It's halftime at Jordan-Hare Stadium in Auburn, Alabama. It's the University of South Florida Bulls and the Auburn Tigers. Our score is Auburn 17, USF 14. Freshman Mario Fannin of the Tigers, and the Tigers have found their running game. So be sure to watch ESPN's College Game Day, built by the Home Depot, every Saturday at 10 a.m. Eastern. Join Chris Fowler, Lee Corso, and Kirk Herbstreit for 2 hours of features, insights, and analysis, getting you ready for all the day's action ahead. We'll be back with more from Auburn right after these messages. Back at Jordan-Hare Stadium in Auburn, Alabama, our score, Auburn 17, USF 14. Dan Fouts and Tim Brand up in the booth. Todd Harris down the sidelines. Kind of a tale of two quarters, Tim. That first quarter ended with South Florida on top 14-3, but it was all the Tigers in that second quarter.
Yeah, the Tigers got their running game, and of course that was Mario Fannin. It was one of those situations where the linebackers were jamming the box, and he was now hitting the corner. Look at him. He's 220 pounds. They talk about how great he will be, and tonight he's starting to give you some indication how talented he is. But that really changed things in this ball game. The defense started causing havoc. It held South Florida to 15 second quarter yards, and that was it. See the two, Mike Ford and Mario Fannin. Ford, 59 yards, most of that in the first quarter. And Fannin, 53 yards, most of that came in the second. So it's really been a tale of two quarters here at Auburn.
And Mario Fannin will get double duty as he's back deep for the Tigers. This kickoff is a short one. Tommy Trotz got it for the Tigers, and he's out to just about the 34-yard line. So, again, good field position to start the second half now for the Tigers.
And if you look at the halftime statistics, you can see the balance. 106 yards rushing for South Florida, 107 for Auburn. One of the things that's not in there, Dan, is the fact that Auburn went for it on fourth down and got it. And that led to a score, and that led to them leading here 17-14.
And that wasn't any old fourth down. It was fourth down and four. They threw for it, got the first down with a pass from Cox to Robert Dunn. This is Ben Tate, right side, and he gets blasted. Middle linebacker Ben Moffitt with a big hit. Todd, what did Coach Leavitt have to say at halftime?
Well, surprisingly, Dan, he wasn't that upset. I said, Coach, what changes do you have to make in the second half to be victorious here at Auburn? He said, the bottom line is we have to tackle better. That's it. We tackle better, we'll take everything else. He said he would like to see the offense move the chains a little better. He said, we don't have to get it all back in one big shot. Let's just move the chains, grind it out, play bowl football. He said, we'll be just fine.
Thank you, Todd. Obviously, Ben Moffitt got the message at halftime after that tackle. Pickup of one for Tate. Fake by Cox. Throws a low for Rodriguez. Incomplete.
Mike Jenkins takes Rodriguez all the way to the sidelines.
Dan, because of the success of Mario Fannin in that first half, now South Florida starting to jam the box, put 8 and 9 guys in the box to stop the run. So it's going to be up to Cox to start passing and pass effectively. You see it there. They went to the pass on second down. Now they've got to go back to a pass. You would think on third down they could still run a draw, but I'd be looking for a screen or something on the outside.
Well, Al Borges loves screen passes. This is third down and 9. Again, 0 for 6 in that first half on third down for Cox and the Tigers. Here's that screen you wanted, Tim. To Stewart. Got blockers out in front. And he's got a first down for Auburn across the 45-yard line. Bingo, huh?
Yeah, and if you're playing defense, they've got to be thinking like I was. You've got to be expecting that screen. That is a big part of their repertoire at Auburn. And it's a high percentage play for Cox. Cox hadn't really been in a rhythm. So now you've got to get out of there. You've got to know the screen's coming. Get out there right now and get through there and break this thing up. Instead, they're slow getting over, and they move the chains.
Tyrone Green, the junior left guard, out in front with a key block. Ben Tate, the tailback. Cox straight back to pass. He's got pressure down the middle into coverage. Knocked away, incomplete. Double coverage again. Mike Jenkins and Nate Allen.
Nate Allen thought he had the interception. He was looking at it all the way, and he was looking for a return. That ball was batted away at the last second. I'm not sure if it was Swinton, but watch this at the very end. Here's Cox, and again, doesn't step into it. He's almost ducking away from the hit when he throws it. And now watch how the ball is batted away at the very last second, and Allen thought, number 5, he had the pick.
That's just another poor decision by Cox. Swinton was double covered down the middle. Here's Tate trying the left side now. And he's met by Bruce Malm-Premier.
Thought it was interesting at halftime when Tommy Tuberville says, listen, we are not hitting on all cylinders yet. Meaning not last week, not this week, yet. And Al Borges, when we talked to him, he says, you know, we just don't have the guys going like they did 2 years ago when they had Cadillac running the football and Jason Campbell at quarterback and the team that went 13-0 in 2004. They are not to that point here at Auburn.
Another third down and long for Cox. 4 wide receivers in the game, 3 at the top of the screen. Tate, the remaining back to the right of Cox. Steps up. Now he's going to run. And he's going to come up just about a yard shy of that first down as he dives to the 45-yard line.
That's encouraging to me. You've got a quarterback that's ducking every time he's throwing, and he showed us the big bruise on his left shoulder and left arm. But a guy that will tuck it away and run and actually take a hit at the end of this thing, that's pretty gutsy. Cox tucks it, looks one last time, and now he's going to run it and knows he's going to get hit and pounded into the ground. Although he does make sure he comes down on that right shoulder.
He's real close to the first down. You look at that yellow line there, but he's going to come up about that much
short.
Shy. But you know what? I would put young Mario Fannin in the ball game here and go for it.
Yeah, let him load the box. Let this kid, Mario Fannin, give him a pretty good dose of here we come.
That yellow line is not official. It's darn close, as was Brandon Cox. But Ben Tate is the tailback.
With the success that Auburn had in that second quarter, I'd come out and I'd say, hey, look, the rules of the game now are straight ahead, no fair dodge, and we're giving it to Fannin. But
Danny,
Fannin's not in there now. It's Tate.
And Danny Perry is the fullback in front of Tate. Quarterback sneak fumble. And it's recovered by Nate Allen. Huge turnover for the Bulls as Brandon Cox fumbles on the quarterback sneak.
Wow. His second turnover, he threw the pick early. Now this one gets away from him.
You never see a fumble on a quarterback sneak that ball pops up in the air like this.
Well, he's got it here, but he actually rubbed it up against Bosley's butt. He got the ball cut off his derriere, and the ball just went up in the air. He had the snap in his hands, and when he tucked it away, he came up off the center, and the ball hit him.
I don't think he needed to leap either with that big offensive line just pushing for that 6 inches. But it's USF ball at the 41. Here's Grothy. And he doesn't get much.
And he paid for that 1 yard at 2 yards.
Boy, didn't he. Craig Stevens, number 46, with another big hit. They have held Grothy in check tonight.
South Florida stays pretty much in a no huddle. They're at the line of scrimmage. Then they'll go up to the line. Now Grothy will read the defense, and then after he reads it, he's looking over because they're reading it at the box too.
Two wide. Excuse me, Tim. Here's a second down pass play by Grothy. A lot of time now. Time running out. Thompson can't get him. Flag down, and Grothy goes down, and that is down by Quentin Groves. That might be a sack there behind the line of scrimmage. That could be a new record tire for Quentin Groves. Let's check out the penalty.
And that's a gimme, too, for the sack. He's got to throw that ball away. Outside the tackle box, just throw it across the line of scrimmage out of bounds.
Incidental face mask, 5-yard face mask, number 97 on the defense, 5 yards from the previous spot.
Huge break.
Second down.
And that repeats the down and takes the sack away.
Takes the record tying sack away from Quentin Groves, but this is the second time tonight that Grothy has taken a big loss. You can see the penalty there, just barely.
But what's the thinking there, Dan? You're a quarterback. Why didn't he throw it away once he's outside the tackle box?
Because he knows that he can run, and he's a darn good runner.
Second down. He gets a break here with the face mask, but you don't want to take that sack. I don't care how good a runner you are. You can't give up 10 yards.
Second down and a long 3 yards near midfield for the Bulls. Grothy one more time on the bootleg. Faking the ball to Benjamin Williams.
Ben Williams hadn't gotten a lot of carries tonight. He's one of those hide-and-seek runners. You know, he's only 5'7". He hides behind the big offensive line, seeks that hole, then explodes. He was the MVP of their bowl game.
I wonder where Mike Ford is. 59 yards rushing in that first half. Third and short for the Bulls. Grothy calls timeout. Auburn 17, USF 14. You're watching ESPN's College Football Primetime. This telecast is available on ESPN2, presented by Pioneer Kuro HD TV. Big play here at midfield.
They've taken
third down and one, Tim.
Taking little Williams out and put Ford in, so they better lock on him.
Ford's got it, and he's got the first down right side behind big Walter Walker, the 330-pound senior right tackle.
Evans and Harness should have been locked on him as soon as they saw the change at running back. When they bring Ford in, they know he's going to get the football. Here he is. He slides to the right, looks for a blocker, just keeps going until he finds that yard, gets three, and they move the chains.
Grothy faked to Ford, and Grothy's got a couple right up the middle. So one adjustment they've made on offense, they want to get Grothy carrying the ball more, apparently.
And it was a good timeout, too, because I don't know if he called the timeout because of the running back change, but it gave the coaches time to get Williams out and get Ford in for the first. You're right, Grothy's going to try to run the ball more. He tried early in the ball game. They get him going, it might open up some things outside as well for the receivers.
Celebrating his 21st birthday today with a one-yard touchdown run in the first quarter. And now he's got five wide receivers in the game, nobody in the backfield with him. Time to throw, and he's got a completion to Jackson. First down, Bulls close to the 30-yard line.
Yeah, once you get Grothy running, they start cheating in a little bit. Then you've got those dangerous wide receivers, and it'll help the passing game.
Well, it really helps the pass protection, too.
Just look up top at Amari Jackson. He's 6'5". It's a little mismatch. He's working against a 5'9 corner. And then you get him in space, and he's going to get some extra yards for you. Amari Jackson, 4 catches last week for 15 yards a catch, and he's got a couple here tonight, 12-yard gain there.
Ford is the tailback. Busby the tight end. Here's Ford right up the middle, and he's caught from behind. Michael Goggins ran him down from behind. Good run blitz that time by the linebacker.
Ford's had a tough time. We talked about how he had to get his academics up. Went to JUCO, didn't like it. His dad died in July. He's really had a tough road, but here he is And he's playing well.
13 carries, 61 yards, and a touchdown. Lost a yard on that play. Over the middle, Grothy. Scott Hester, and Hester is close to a first down. He's got a first down. Time now to check in with Stan Verrett. Stan? Thank you, Stan. First down and 10 for the Bulls. Williams trying to find something to the outside.
Tries to salvage
something out of nothing.
Cole Brennan's one of my guys. I've got him. He ought to be in that Heisman race and ought to be mentioned just as much as John David Booty and the rest of them. He can throw as well as anybody in the country, but because of Hawaii and their schedule, everybody says, oh, it's too easy. And, I mean, they may run the table. Hawaii may run the table. And Brennan ought to be mentioned for the Heisman.
No, I just think his haircut should get him a mention.
Sure.
He has the Hawaiian Islands cut into the side of his head.
Maui's a little large, but the rest of them are okay.
Grothy in trouble. Now he dumps it off and incomplete. Better off dumping that incomplete. Quentin Groves is down, as is another teammate. They must have collided there trying to get to Grothy. Antonio Coleman and Groves slow getting up.
Boy, what a collision at the quarterback. My. He's just a little bit dazed, hopefully.
Now Groves is up. Coleman still down.
Groves, 54, is a preseason Lombardi watch guy. Bronco Nagurski and Hendricks Award, big-time player. Here's the collision again, right at Grothy. Hat on hat.
How does Grothy avoid being injured on that play?
I don't know, but he's up. He's a little bit dazed. Just hope Coleman gets up now. Grothy walked away like nothing happened.
Is it possible that both defensive ends, their speed pass rushers, knocked out of the game on one play?
Well, Coleman's getting up. He's moving everything, so that's a good thing.
Remember, those two combined for the clinching points last week against K-State when Groves forced the fumble by Josh Freeman and Coleman ran it in from 34 yards out for a touchdown. But he's just tingling all over right now.
Yeah, he really is. He's moving that right arm and he's indicating that he's got some pins and needles in that arm. So those two guys go out. Let's see what happens here on third down in a taxi ride.
Big Sen'Derrick marks in for Coleman. Third and 13. Time to throw. Ball caught by Edwards, and he's pushed back. Just looking to get the ball in better field goal range.
I'll say it again. Auburn's secondary can be dominant, and here's one of the reasons. What Powers is really good, number 8. 5'9", 183 pounds. He'll play at the next level. Watch how fast he breaks on the ball, number 8. Here's the throw. Here's the break. Here's the hit. Boy, perfectly played, and he broke down before the tackle.
Alvarado will try a 37-yard field goal out of the hold of Anthony Severino. And he's not going to make it. Way, way wide left. Had the leg, but not the direction. So Auburn maintains their 3-point lead. You're watching ESPN's College Football Primetime.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Nissan, who invites you to shift the way you move through the world. And ESPN Game Plan. See the most college football every Saturday. To order, call your pay-per-view provider. ESPN Game Plan lives here.
We're in Auburn, Alabama, the loveliest village of the plain. Auburn on top, 17-14.
He's got to locate the safety right there. That's his first read.
He's going to hand on the draw to Tate. And Tate is going to get bottled up in the middle of that defense. Robert Kleber with the initial stop. Todd Harris, conversations on the sidelines with these coaches, huh?
Dan, I'll tell you what, timing is everything. You know, Will Muschamp, his defense holds, keeps him out of field goal, keeps him out of the end zone, and he tears in. I mean, literally just tears the defense apart about they're not stepping up enough. When the offense wasn't able to convert, it was Hugh Nall that was tearing into the offensive line, and that's when Cox threw the interception, and Al Borg just went over and said, it's okay. So it must be quarterbacks. I don't know, are they fragile or what?
On the sidelines there, calling the plays. That was a swing pass out to Carl Stewart. Thank you, Todd.
Quarterbacks are fragile.
Yeah, when they shouldn't be when they're 22 years old, though. It should be tough. Third down and six. That's Rod Smith in motion. And the pass is to Smith, and he's tackled short of the first down.
We really are seeing some terrific secondary play here today. The corners break on the ball. They get there immediately. They're making good, solid tackles. Watch the top of the screen. He sits under the first down marker, and the contact is made as soon as he touches the football. It's perfectly timed.
Michael Jenkins there with that play. Along with Trey Williams, a lot of people that follow this outfit feel they are the two best shutdown corners in college football. Patrick Tatum comes on now. He's in relief of Ryan Shoemaker, who was injured in the first half. His second punt of the game. Tail dragger. Marcus Edwards. He's going to run out of room as Tommy Trott rolls him out of bounds just shy of the 35-yard line.
It's okay. He got positive yardage, and they're going to have the field position now starting at the 35-yard line.
39-yard punt for Tatum, 3-yard return for Edwards. It's Bulls ball in good field position. .3200 Bulls fans on hand tonight, watching their Bulls hang in against the number 17 in the country, Auburn Tigers. 5 wide receivers on first down for Matt Grothy. Time to throw. Over the middle, throws low, incomplete. Well, South Florida had upset top 10 teams each of the last two seasons. In 2005, they upset number 9 Louisville, 45-14. Amari Jackson scores on a reverse. Brian Brohm is intercepted there. Then in 06, South Florida upset number 7 West Virginia in Morgantown, 24-19. Selby gets a touchdown there. And then Matt Grothy's touchdown pass seals the win. Is there another upset in the offing?
Well, they sure believe they can. And 17-14, they keep it close to the end. They believe they can steal it.
Great pass protection, but Grothy is off target, trying to get it to Jesse Hester Jr. across the middle.
And that's two in a row. You know, you got to give Mike Trangisi, the head of the Big East, a lot of credit. Give the Big East a lot of credit. I mean, they were almost dead when the ACC took some of their schools. Now they've got South Florida in there. They've got Louisville. They have West Virginia. And if you look at the standings right now, the only team in that conference with a loss is Syracuse. Nobody else has lost in that entire conference. Best record right now in the country.
Syracuse has lost when they put on those uniforms.
Oh, stop it.
Third down and 10. Ball on the 34-yard line. Grothy with 5 wide receivers. 5-man rush. Trying to get the ball downfield. There's a flag on Eric Brock. Taurus Johnson says, oh, yeah, you pushed me, buddy.
Without a doubt.
I've noticed one thing about Grothy, Tim. He does not look very comfortable or accurate when he throws standing in the pocket. I think he's much more accurate on the run.
Well, this ball was pretty well thrown, though, and you look at the contact that's made early by Brock.
33 on the defense. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Brock says no, but the answer is yes. He was there early, and the reason he was there early is because he knew he was beaten. He was chasing, and when you're chasing, you're in trouble.
And Will Muschamp will give him an earful because that was third down and 10.
And if the ball was thrown on time, the ball was thrown out in front of him, it's a touchdown. Grothy hangs in as long as he can. He's waiting for him to clear. Here comes the pressure. He feels the pocket closing down, and he still throws it just before he gets hit. And they move it 15 yards with the penalty.
Quentin Grove still on the sidelines. Antonio Coleman in back in the game. This is Mike Ford trying the left side.
Mike Ford did not seem to have the same bounce in his stride on that play. He's getting more carries than he's had in a long, long time here tonight.
Yeah, but that ball's not heavy, right?
No, but I tell you, it's about 90 degrees and getting a little winded.
And good sign for Tiger fans. 54 back in the game, Quentin Groves. And they run right inside Groves as he's rushing up the field, taken out of the play by Walter Walker.
He's getting a little heavy-legged. This is a running back that lets his eyes move his feet, reads the holes well, usually explodes through them, but just his body language, there's a little fatigue right now. They're going to try to spread this defense thin.
USF just 3 of 9 on third down conversions. Third down and three.
Three wides.
A lot of threes. Ford wrapped up by Groves. Short of the first down. Both Groves and Coleman in on that tackle.
And Ford slow getting up. I'm surprised they went back to him and didn't try to get Grothy to throw for the first. Boy, Groves is coming off with a limp again. He may have cramps. It's hot. Guys are struggling.
Delbert Alvarado will try to pin the Tigers deep in their own end of the field here with this punt. And it's a beautiful high tail-dragging spiral. Fair catch by Dunn made inside the 10-yard line. Great punt by Delbert Alvarado.
Let's go back and look at number 54 for Auburn, Quentin Rose. See if we can see what's happening. Here he comes in with the tackle. Gets a good lick. Ford's pretty big. He's riding him. He's got to wrestle him to the ground. This is strength versus strength. Keep an eye on the legs there of Groves. Didn't see him get hit. Maybe just cramping up. He had to use a lot of muscles. And look at him. He's saying, that guy is big. That guy is strong. I had a tough time getting him down. Rope that doggy.
He had a tough time getting Josh Freeman, the huge K-State quarterback, down last weekend.
Saying he's forward tough.
Here's Fannin, left side. Good cut. Fumble. Florida's got it. Tyler Roberts picks up the loose ball. Third turnover of the night, and this one is a killer deep in the Tiger territory.
What a game that Nate Allen is playing, number 5. Watch him come up. There's the tackle. Right arm strips the ball. Just punched it right out of there. That is really nicely done by the free safety, number 5. You see the right arm? The right hand pushes it out. Just took him inside out, kept his leverage, stripped him. Roberts comes up with it. That is huge.
Nate Allen punching that ball loose, the sophomore from Cape Coral, Florida.
Now it's up to Matt Grothy. You look at the turnovers, Auburn's got 3 of them. But now Grothy has to turn these into points.
Two wide receivers at the top of the screen. Here's Ben Williams spinning. And not getting much, but not going down either.
Yeah, you got fresh legs in there. See, Williams hadn't been running much. Ford was tired. Williams comes back. And again, I tell you, he's that hide-and-seek runner. He's only 5'7", little bowling ball, so he hides behind the big offensive lineman, seeks that opening, and then he explodes.
Williams, the MVP of last year's Papa John's .com Bowl. The win over East Carolina. They're having trouble finding him, aren't they?
Yeah, look at him. He's a little whirling dervish.
The dervish got 3. Fake. Here's Grothy. And Grothy's going to get about 4 more. Tackled by Josh Thompson.
And this will bring up a big third down play. Now, the tendency so far for South Florida, if I'm playing defense, their tendency has been to run on third down. Jim Leavitt, let's see if he breaks tendencies and throws.
I don't know. They got the hammer in. Mike Ford is in the backfield.
I know, but you also have your mismatch guy, number 18. He's 6'5", sitting down here in the bottom of the screen, right here.
That's Amari Jackson against Jonathan Wilhite. There's the fake to Ford. Pressure by Groves. Grothy in trouble, and down he goes.
Boy, he was looking for Jackson, too. We had it picked right. He was trying to go there. There was just too much pressure. Quinton Groves on one side, Marks on the other, and they were squeezing him quickly.
Big Pat Sims gets the sack. Good teamwork with that man, Quinton Groves.
This is who he was looking for. You've got 6'5 working against 5'9 and a half, but he couldn't get there. First, he's double covered, but then Groves was coming. And they say Groves has learned to convert speed to power. 41 career starts.
45-yard kick is way left. That might go out of bounds. Delbert Alvarado. Ball might have been tipped by Eric Brock. He laid out. This ball was just missed by a mile.
And look at the Bulls fans you just looked at. And now look at the Auburn fans. This tells the story of the game.
Yeah, the other thing that USF fans know is that they've got 3 Auburn turnovers and 0 points to show for it.
Well, that's why they're holding their heads, because they know they've had 3 missed opportunities. You cannot upset Auburn at Auburn and miss opportunities like that.
First and 10, Auburn, 27-yard line. Fannin fumbles, and South Florida's got it again. Tyrone McKenzie has got the ball.
Well, you talk about mood swings.
2 fumbles in the last 2 plays for Mario Fannin and the Auburn Tigers.
He just drops his football. Here's the handoff. There's the take. Hit off his chest plate, it looks like. His shoulder pads. He never pulled it in. The handoff, he tries to take it two-handed. Never squeezes down on it. Look at this. I think it hits the bottom of his chest plate.
And rolls right to number 27, Tyrone McKenzie. Flags all over the place before that ball snapped.
A lot of movement before the snap.
Before the snap, ball start, number 65 on the offense, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
5 penalties now against South Florida.
But 0 points off of 4 takeaways. That'll drive that man absolutely bonkers.
And that man, too.
Mike Ford is flanked all the way at the bottom of the screen. Grothy by himself in the shotgun. Throws to the left side. He's got Hester. And Hester's got the ball at the 20-yard line. Out of bounds.
That's not a bad formation to stay in if you're South Florida. 5 wide receivers. Ace backfield. You spread the defense thin. And it takes some of the pressure off Grothy.
Now you really spread the defense thin, because you've got a corner now having to guard Ford all the way out. Split wide to the right, as he is one more time. He's that number 5 that Tim's showing you. 2nd down and 7. Grothy again, left side, in trouble. Down he goes. Antoine Carter with the sack. Number 45. But again, Tim, it's Grothy hanging onto the ball when he should just dump it away.
Seen that several times tonight. And they're only rushing 4. They back the linebacker out.
3rd and 18 now. Groves and Coleman back in the game. Swing pass out here to Ford. He's got some room. And he punishes tacklers as he goes out of bounds.
But again,
Mike McNeil takes the big shot from Ford.
And Dan, with that run, they put themselves back in field goal position to tie the game. But now you say, wait a minute, he's missed 2 so badly to the left.
I'm not sure what field goal range is anymore for Delbert. He's got a big leg. We talked about that 56-yarder against Syracuse last year, but his last 2 misses have been awful.
Confidence can't be very high.
Anthony Severino sets it down from 37 yards away. Block. Oh, he took an eternity to kick that ball.
That's a lack of confidence. He didn't want to move on the ball. He didn't trust himself when the ball was snapped. This crowd is bipolar. 1 minute they're cheering, and then they're down in the dumps.
They're cheering now. Four turnovers, 0 points for the USF Bulls.
Wow. Right over the top.
Sen'Derrick Marks will get credit for it. End of the third quarter. Auburn 17, USF 14. Jordan-Hare Stadium in Auburn, Alabama. Rocking and rolling tonight. Fourth quarter starting here. Auburn on top by three. And they've got the ball. This is Ben Tate, left side. And Tate gets forward for about three.
You have to wonder when the opportunities are going to cease for South Florida. Auburn had three fumbles in the third quarter. South Florida started on the 41, the 21, and the 23, and they missed all three field goals. Here's what we're talking about. Four takeaways, no points, three missed field goals, one block, five penalties. South Florida should be leading this football game.
Here's Tate, right side. And a fine play out of the secondary. Ball came loose, but it's ruled down by our line judge, Terry Walters. Mike Jenkins with a fine tackle from the corner position.
Dan, the most impressive thing to me tonight have been the corners for South Florida. Mike Jenkins and Trey Williams will both play in the NFL. I don't think there is any question about that. Both guys have great speed. They've got strength. They break on the football. They make tackles. They make interceptions. And terrifically smart, talented players.
And both are seniors, so enjoy them while you got them, Bulls fans. One of nine on third down for Brandon Cox and the Tigers. That's Tommy Trott in motion. Cox changing the play. Play clock running way down. Time to throw across the middle. He's got his man, Rodriguez. And Rodriguez has got an Auburn first down. Trey Williams on the stop, but not before Rodriguez picks up a huge first down on that 16-yard gain.
Boy, watch this. They run a clear out. They run a deep pattern right down the middle, and Rodriguez comes underneath. They were in a two-deep, five-under zone. He found the soft spot underneath, and Cox just let him have it. That was nicely well-designed and well-executed.
And well-protected. George Selvey's not getting anywhere near the quarterback thanks to big number 77, King Dunlap. Here's Cox. He's going to throw on first down. Again, a crossing route, and that one's dropped by Rodriguez. And he had running room.
And that's one of the few times tonight we've seen Brandon Cox step into the football, and you could almost count the revolutions on the spiral. It was tight. It was right there. And Rodriguez just took his eyes off of it. It went right through his hands.
First things first.
Steps into it. Look at that spiral. Look where it is. Whew. And it goes right through his hands. Perfectly thrown by Brandon Cox.
Had his hands crossed the wrong way. Second and 10 now from the 44-yard line. Here's Tate. Flag down. Tate running over tacklers and gets knocked out of bounds by Tyrone McKenzie. Check out this flag.
Both teams have one good play this way, one bad play the other way.
12:54 to go here in the ballgame. Auburn on top, 17-14.
Illegal formation. Six men on the line on the offense. Number five was back. It's a five-yard penalty from the previous spot. Repeat second down.
Tommy Tuberville told us that, you know, these fans expect him to blow teams out every week. He just wants the W's. Had 11 wins last year. Five of Auburn's wins were by 7 points or less, including the 17-14 Cotton Bowl win over Nebraska. So they win close ball games, especially here in Auburn.
Sixth penalty against the Tigers. Brings up second down and 15 now. Tate is the tailback. Bunch receivers. Tate will run behind those receivers for a while. Now he's in trouble. Bruce Mompremier with another tackle for a loss. And the Tigers are going backwards. Todd, Mario Fannin's having trouble hanging on to the ball.
I kid in Fauci. Mario Fannin is getting a little Tommy Tuberville Borges doghouse time. When he fumbled the first time, he came off, and Brad Lester, who's not playing, and Ben Tate consoled him, said it's all right, don't worry about it. He fumbled the second time. There was not a soul around him. If he gets in again and fumbles again, I think Coach Tuberville might just tell him, why don't you head to the locker room, son?
Especially the second one, he wasn't even hit. He just dropped the ball. Third down and 20 now for Cox. He runs out, and down he goes. That is George Selvey, and that's his fifth sack of the season, first tonight.
George Selvey was very patient there because Cox was running out of patience. He looked, he looked, he looked, he felt the pressure and bailed out, and Selvey was waiting for him. Jim Leavitt saying, all right, fellas, think, be smart here. We're going to get good field position. Watch number 95. He's going to be at the right of your screen. He's buying time, buying time. There's Cox. Here he comes. Bam.
Patrick Tatum in the game to punt it away for the Tigers. This is Mario Edwards tracking it down at about the 31. Makes one miss and then gets knocked out of bounds at the 35-yard line. Fine punt by Tatum of 40 yards, 4 yards on the return by Edwards. 11:21 to go in the ball game. Auburn 17, South Florida 14. You're watching ESPN's College Football Primetime.
Down and 10 from the 35-yard line. Passing formation. Jamar Taylor is the tailback, flagged down, and ball almost intercepted. Zach Etheridge almost picked that one off.
Brothy now 12 for 20. Game's getting away from him. The field's getting away from him. I think he's frustrated. He likes to run the football, but they're in a situation where they have to pass, not because of time, not because of the score, but because they've been unsuccessful. Ford has dead legs. Ben Williams really hadn't been getting the job done. And most of their success has been passing. So, Jim Lewis.
Illegal formation, six men on the line of scrimmage on the offense. Number 78 was not up. That's a 5-yard penalty. Repeat first down.
That's Mark Dial, left tackle.
Jim Leavitt doesn't like the call either.
Good to see Dial in the game. He had some stomach problems yesterday as we were visiting the ball club. Some concern as to whether he was even going to play today.
Again, five wides.
One of those wides is Jamar Taylor. Grothy escapes. Now he throws. He's got his man over the middle. That's Taurus Johnson. And that's close to, and it is a first down for South Florida.
That is where Grothy is so dangerous. As soon as he pulled that ball down and started to run, the defense then left their receivers. And once he got close to the line of scrimmage, he let it go. That's Doug Flutie-esque. Watch this. Five receivers, definitely a pass play. Now he pulls it down, starts to run. Guys get away. They get out of their hook zones, and he throws in the soft area.
Here's Taylor. Taylor jumping back inside. But I really think he's more comfortable throwing on the move. And Auburn's done a good job with their ends, keeping him contained inside, but he stepped inside that contained that one.
I don't think there's any question about it. You watch him. He is much more comfortable throwing on the run. When he steps back and he's sitting in the pocket, he does not like it. And he doesn't throw nearly as well.
Taylor got 2 yards on that run. 10:25 to go. Taylor, one more time, another short game.
Yeah, it's just they're finding it tough going here on the run. They're best off when he puts pressure on the corner, moves a little bit, then he's got the option to run or pass.
Very conservative play calling for Jim Leavitt and the Bulls. Offensive coordinator Gregory choosing the run, but this is a third down and 7. Swings it outside to Taylor.
and Taylor's got a first down, South Florida.
There's a flag, though.
But a flag is down, Tim.
And Jim Leavitt just threw his headset down, so I'm guessing by that reaction, it's against South Florida.
That's a good guess.
He picked it back up, but he's hot.
The only coach in South Florida history, he built this program to where it is a major contender.
Number 89 on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Repeat third down.
Torres Johnson, the guilty party.
Torres Johnson, here's the screen pass. Here are the blocks. Torres Johnson right there with his right arm around him. You see him now saying, nope, that's a mistake. Don't ever raise your hands like you're guilty. Like, I didn't do it. Don't ever say, I didn't do it, because then they know you did.
He was holding Patrick Lee, no question about that. They're down and 13 for Grothy. Here's the pressure. There's the throw over the middle. Hester's got it. First down, Florida, South Florida. And a flag is down late. This could be a personal foul on the hit or a face mask.
Boy, Grothy could not have waited any longer, and he knew he was going to take the hit. That's a big-time throw and a big-time catch.
Yeah, the coaches call him a gamer. Kids today would call him a baller.
Incidental face mask, number 26 on the defense. 5-yard penalty from the end of the run. It'll be first and 10.
True freshman Mike McNeil with the incidental face mask grab.
Groves and Marks are coming off the end, and watch Groves. He's got a perfect shot at him and takes him down. Grothy waited to the very last second to throw that baby.
Best throw of the night for Matt Grothy. Here's Ford, right side. Pat Sims jumps on his back there.
You know, it's been a while since we saw Ford. They gave him a pretty good breather. Tried to get those legs going again, see if he could lighten those legs. And right now, he feels like he's wearing cement shoes.
This is Walter Walker down on the field. This is a huge loss if Walker can't continue.
Big old Walter Walker, 6'5", 233 pounds. If you were with us at the beginning of the game, he helped us do the lineups, and they're working on his ankle. You can see the ankles are taped under that sock. You can see where the tape is. So
now, while they're tending to big Walter Walker, we'll take this break. Auburn 17, USF 14, but USF is on the move.
ESPN's College Football Primetime, brought to you by Chase Freedom. Finally, a credit card that lets you switch between cashback and points. And the ultra-thin Helio Fin by Samsung. Don't call it a phone.
Back at Auburn, Alabama, where the University of South Florida Bulls and their fans are looking at a second down and 7. Just under 9 minutes to go in this one. Grothy's got it, right side, and he's close to a first down, knocked out of bounds by Eric Brock, but Grothy showing his toughness, taking on the DB.
He didn't hesitate either. He reacted quickly. As soon as he read it, he committed, and he ran.
And he got the first down.
He looks, fakes, tucks, and goes. Now he sees that it's Brock, it's one-on-one, and he lowers his shoulder and gets up near that first down marker, and they move the chains.
That's a running back who plays quarterback.
You're right.
That type of mentality.
He better keep moving, too, because they can't hit field goals.
First and 10 on the 25. This is Ford right up the middle. And what Leavitt's thinking right now is that with Ford's size at 225, that he's going to wear down this Auburn defense and maybe break a big one. But well, you're right, Tim. They're in field goal range now, and that may be bad news for South Florida.
Well, Auburn had 3 fumbles in that third quarter. South Florida started on 41, they're 21 and the 23, and they missed all 3 field goals, and they weren't even close. And there's Delbert Alvarado. Right now, his confidence level is just like the number of field goals he's hit, 0.
4 wide receivers on this second down and 8 for Grothy. Groves misses him. And Grothy crosses the line of scrimmage and then goes out of bounds. But Quentin Groves, he can't believe he didn't make that sack.
I want to go back to Delbert Alvarado. You know, we're talking about their field goal kicker. Just watch his movements. This one way left. All right, now the next one, he gets another shot. It is farther left. That's almost over by the tunnel. And then he's afraid to approach the ball. His confidence slows him down, and he gets it blocked.
And he gets it blocked by a guy who's 6'1", 290, Sen'Derrick Marks. Not exactly a skywalker. Third and six for Grothy from the 21. Over the middle, knocked down. Sen'Derrick Marks one more time getting a hand up.
Boy, I want to tell you something, too. Groves tattooed Grothy. He came off that corner and put his eyes on that number eight and throws him down on that left shoulder.
I'm surprised they're not going for it, to be honest with you.
He's good because he plays with bad intentions.
38-yard intended field goal here for Delbert Alvarado. And he's got it.
How about that?
That's bouncing back, Delbert. Good job.
Look at Jim Leavitt. Perseverance, baby. Stay after it. He's saying you may win this game for us yet. And he says, wow, he can't believe it.
Those are the first points in a long time. Kicking in rhythm, Delbert Alvarado ties this game. You're watching ESPN's College Football Primetime.
The 25 greatest players in college football history, presented by IBM. Coming in 1 week, IBM getting it done.
Those top 25 greatest players was voted on by a Blue Ribbon panel of former coaches, former players, and media members, and we'll reveal 25 through number one over the course of the season, announcing the greatest player in college football on the last week of the regular season. Don't forget to check that out.
How far back do they go, partner? You ought to be in there.
No, you got to be an All-American at least. I was hardly even All-Coast almost.
Well, Craig James voted, so I know he voted for himself.
Here's Tichy kicking off. That's Ben Tate. And Tate goes down the sidelines and is cartwheeled out of bounds at the 27-yard line. Well, Monday Night Football returns to ESPN with a doubleheader. First at 7 Eastern, it's the Baltimore Ravens taking on the Cincinnati Bengals. Carson Palmer and company. Then at 10:15 Eastern, it's Matt Leinart and the Arizona Cardinals taking on the San Francisco 49ers. Don't miss the return of Monday Night Football with a doubleheader here on ESPN. 17-all our score, 7:41 to go in the ballgame. Cox to throw on first down. Time to throw. Intercepted. Mike Jenkins has got it. 10-5, diving for the end zone. He's out of bounds at the 3-yard line.
Dan, I've said it throughout this entire ball game. Jenkins and Williams are as good of cornerbacks as anybody in this league, and they're going to play on Sundays. They read, they jump the ball, they break quickly. Here we go now. Mike Jenkins is reading this all the way. He breaks on the ball, makes the interception. He's got great speed. He's going to try to score, but he's not going to make it. But that whole play was made by reading the eyes of Cox. Cox led him there by his head, his eyes. He took him over that way. He broke from the football and made the pick. That's about as pretty a play as you can make in the secondary.
And South Florida is going to have to call a timeout. They're not even at the line of scrimmage, having personnel issues. Five turnovers for the Tigers, two interceptions. Four of those turnovers have happened here in the second half.
How about this? In the second half, five possessions, two punts, three fumbles, and two first downs for Auburn. That's it. Now you add the interception to there, and there's six. I mean, it's just not a good second half for any football team, much less Auburn playing at home.
And again, if you look at the scoreboard at the top of the screen, those little yellow hash marks are the timeouts remaining. USF only has one, and we're in a tie ball game. Auburn with all three of theirs. Just about 3,200 fans made the trip over here from Tampa to follow their Bulls. They're liking what they're seeing right now.
Yeah, they're close to something really special. Auburn is 12-1 at night games at home since 2000. They do not lose these home games at night. And South Florida is about to take them to the woodshed here.
Three running backs in the game, Ford, Williams, and Taylor for Grothy under center. This is Ford, right side. Stiff arm. Brock's got him, and Brock's got him out of bounds with help from Quentin Groves. You don't want Mike Ford running laterally. You want him running right at the defense. Doesn't quite have that speed to get to the corner.
No, but the Bulls are trying to turn an Auburn turnover into points, something they haven't been able to do all night. This guy's big and he's strong. He's really going to be good.
Sen'Derrick marks with the play push, forcing him to go wide. Grothy now with three tight ends in the game, fakes to Williams. And Mike McNeil from his safety spot comes up and makes the tackle. Big play by Mike McNeil, the true freshman.
They don't run it much, but a little play action here and a little roll would be a touchdown for sure. Guys are loading the box. They know runs are coming. A little play action would be great.
Yeah, the problem here for Grothy is that the wide side of the field is the left side. Tough for a right-handed quarterback to throw moving that way.
Haven't seen this formation. Let's see what they run.
Three running backs.
Option.
It's the option. That's Samuels. Flag down. Samuels nowhere near the end zone.
South Florida's going with no huddle most of the night. Grothy runs a lot. They try to chip Groves and keep him in man coverage. They've controlled the game and the clock.
Illegal formation. 6 men on the line on the offense. The penalty is declined. It will be fourth down.
The thing they haven't been able to do is turn the turnovers into points. And again, they're having trouble.
And here's Delbert Alvarado. Made a 38-yarder his last time out. Missed from 37, 45. Had one from 37 blocked.
He's got a tough angle,
this
too.
This is a chippy, though.
From the left hash.
21 yards. Severino to put it down. Eric Setzer to snap it. Good snap, good hold. Missed it left. That's that tough angle you were talking about, Tim.
Yeah, you could almost feel it, especially with a guy that's 1 for 4. He doesn't have a lot of confidence. Now you put him at a tough angle, and you're asking him to kind of aim it. Nightmare.
Tie ball game. 21-yarder just barely left. You're watching ESPN's College Football Primetime. Back at Jordan-Hare Stadium, 6:13 to go in a ball game, all tied up at 17. This is the turnover story. Four of these turnovers have happened this half. First and 10 now from the 20-yard line. Tate is behind Carl Stewart. He gets it on the draw, and he'll get maybe 2 yards. Well, you like comparisons. Auburn has been around forever. South Florida just starting up their 11th season. How about 9-win seasons for the two teams? 22 for Auburn, just 2 for South Florida. How about All-Americans? Well, South Florida still looking for their first. Well, Auburn's had 67. First-round draft picks? Well, you get the idea, but South Florida is a program on the rise, but they've got to make a field goal every now and then. Cox to throw, got a wide-open Rod Smith across the 40-yard line, trying to get out of bounds, but he does pick up the first down. That will stop the clock while they move the chains.
Still no hurry, 5:32 to play in the game. You see the all three timeouts that they have. Those yellow things right there under the name are the timeouts. They've got all three of those.
Those being timeouts. Or as our friend Keith Jackson would say, time's out. It's more grammatically correct.
Point is, Cox now just has to manage the game. You see him reading. You see him making his reads. Locating the safeties.
Done in motion. And Dunn gets it on the reverse. Good block by Carl Stewart. And Dunn gets out of bounds after a good gain. A little trickery for the Tigers.
Al Borges, the offensive coordinator, looking on. Play is relayed into Cox. He's got that. Now he goes in. He looks at the play clock. Got plenty of time, 20 seconds.
Dunn picked up six on the end around.
They actually want to melt some of that clock, not give South Florida much if they get it back.
Straight back to pass is Cox. Throws to the outside. He's got Dunn. Dunn's got a first down, and Dunn gets out of bounds. In front of Trey Williams. Time now to check in with Stan Verrett. Stan? First and 10 for Brandon Cox. He's going to throw again. He's got his tight end, Gabe McKenzie, another Auburn first down.
Split the two deep with the tight end right down the middle, Gabe McKenzie. And again, you're starting to count the revolutions on Cox throws. He's got that tight spiral. And again, he throws on time and in rhythm. He's looking at the safety there, number 5, Allen. He sees him, goes the other side of McKenzie, throws a nice pass where only his guy can get it. And again, they move it down inside the 30.
That's a good point, Timmy. Threw the ball away from the safety, Nate Allen, for that 19-yard gain.
Halfback pass.
No, I don't think so, according to Ben Moffitt.
Guarantee you that's what they were trying to do.
He was loaded up, wasn't he?
He was. They also, you know, running backs run differently when they're about to throw, too.
You know, think?
Oh, my gracious. Stewart came that time, and it almost looked like he took a wide stance, and he just started moving his feet. I'm telling you. Watch him here. Oh, baby. He's loaded up, but at the same time, he's looking, and he sees Moffitt coming at him. Yeah, so he knew he was going to be tattooed.
He's lucky he didn't fumble. Trying to get that ball into throwing position there. Big loss on the play of 7. That's Dunn in motion. Cox with a quick throw out to McKenzie. McKenzie slips one, dives forward inside the 30-yard line. Good effort by the big tight end. Bruce Mompremier made the tackle.
You know, McKenzie caught the touchdown pass last week that locked the game. 3-yard touchdown catch. And we were talking to Tommy Tuberville, and he said Sunday he went into the office and he said, why was McKenzie in there on a play we had to throw? Because they don't think of him as a great receiver. But he made a one-handed grab. He made two other catches. We saw him at practice pulling the ball in. He catches the ball just fine.
And he's got 7 catches on the season, 3 tonight, and he did catch a touchdown pass earlier. 3rd and 12. Cox to the end zone, almost intercepted. Ryan Gilliam almost picked that one off as Cox throws into coverage one more time.
And Gilliam knows he should have had it. That was an interception, and he wants that one back. Look how frustrated he is. He did everything right but catch the football. He's reading Cox, reading him, breaks, here it is, steps in front, goes and gets it at his highest point, and it goes through his hands.
Boy, I would play zone defense against Brandon Cox all night long. Just sit back and watch his eyes. He's going to tell you where he's throwing the ball. Here's Wes Byram from 46 yards. Matthew Motley will put it down, and timeout, South Florida.
Well within his range.
And that will run Jim Leavitt out of timeouts. Todd Harris.
Well, Dan and Tim, Coach Leavitt did not want to burn that timeout, but they only had 10 players on the field. Someone forgot their assignment, and the coach is livid. They had to burn their final timeout. So if and when they get the ball back now, they'll have to operate and try to make a run here with no timeouts left.
You know, he should be frustrated. I looked around and I said, he can't be trying to freeze the clock, or freeze the kicker, rather. He's got 2:59 on the clock in a tie ball game. You need that timeout at the end to win it or to get back in it. And 10 players on the field explains it, but that is a mental lapse by the special teams that could cost them a ball game. If you're on the field goal block team, you better be paying attention.
That's Wes Byram. Matthew Motley will put it down. Robert Shiver will snap it back for this 46-yard attempt. And it hooks in. Good. Nice little power draw there by Wes Byram.
You know, Wes replaced John Vaughn, who was a finalist for the Luke Rose Award last year, Auburn's all-time leading scorer. He steps in, and his first 2 weeks have just been phenomenal.
Now, Tommy Tuberville said defense and special teams, this kick is very special. It looked like for a moment it was going to stay outside of the uprights and then just hooked right in.
So he's made a 49er and a 46er. That's impressive. Now you go across the other side and you say South Florida's got a chance to win this football game. 2:54 left. I'm not sure Delbert Alvarado is going to be the answer, but Matt Grothy could be.
Auburn has turned the ball over five times and yet are leading on the scoreboard with 2:54 to go, and Matt Grothy has no timeouts to work with.
No, but that kid's a leader. He's a competitor. He understands the game and he knows what's left on that clock and the possibilities that exist.
Zach Kutch will kick it for the Tigers to Jerome Murphy or Taurus Johnson. They're standing at about the 10-yard line. Jerome Murphy coming left side. Jerome Murphy all the way to the 34-yard line.
This is where that new rule comes into play. Kicking from the 30. Even if you stay in your lanes, you've got so much room and so much distance to go, you create space for the return guy. Now, once he has it at this hash mark, watch him try to even increase more space. Goes all the way to the other side of the field. He's got one to beat. The contain man came way too far inside. Then he breaks two tackles and almost took it to the house. If you're a little kid playing in your backyard now, and you're Matt Grothy, you're saying, Auburn, I'm down 3 points, 2:41 to go. I can win this football game.
Here's Grothy. Left side. Smartly gets out of bounds in front of Zach Etheridge. That was a 59-yard return, and you know who got the key block for him that sent him down the sidelines was tailback Benjamin Williams.
Yeah, they say Benji Williams, when he watches the tapes, he doesn't like to watch himself carry the ball. He likes to see how many guys he can blow up. Grothy is in a situation I'm sure he thrives on. He loves this.
Grothy got about 5.5 on that. Clock stopped at 2:35. Grothy, quick throw over the middle. He's got Johnson. Johnson inside the 10-yard line. Gerard Powers with the tackle there.
Problem is, and this is going to sound silly, but the problem is they're going to score too quickly. Watch the bottom of the screen. You got Tripp's receivers. He just sits down on the other side of the first down marker, and Grothy hits him in stride, on time, in rhythm.
Broke the tackle of Chris Evans. First down and goal.
You got to like this kid, Dan. He's a gunslinger.
Mike Ford is the tailback, and Ford's got it. Pounding that left side and not getting much. Josh Thompson, among others.
And Mark Dial is down. You mentioned he was sick when we went to visit the team yesterday at the hotel. He was in there and he was regurgitating, which really will dehydrate you. And you come in a hot night when it's 80-some degrees in here. It was 96 today. You know he's got to be somewhat dehydrated. And he's holding now. He's just hanging that left arm.
Well, good news for the Bulls. Walter Walker's back in the game. Now Jared Kearns will go over to the left side to take Mark Dial's spot. Number 70. Grothy. Empty backfield. Blitz by Auburn. Throw to the outs. Almost intercepted. Mike McNeil almost picked that one off. Patrick Lee, rather. McNeil was coming on the blitz.
I think Patrick Lee was shocked because he was going left to cover the guy and the ball was going right, but it looked like it was intended for Lee. Here comes the pressure. They come with a blitz. They don't blitz often, but when they do, you know it. Now watch this. This ball is like it's thrown to Lee, like it was intended for Lee, and he overran it.
Third and goal from the 8-yard line. Five wide receivers for Grothy. Good catch on the snap. Quick throw. It's complete to Hester over the middle down to the 1-yard line. McNeil on the stop there. Now, decision time for Jim Leavitt. You got to go for the win.
Well, you have no timeouts left. You got 1:30 on the clock, and it continues to run. Your field goal kickers missed four field goals.
But don't take so much time that the play clock runs out here.
You can't stop it, and it's already down to 20, 22, 21, 20. Jim Leavitt's got to go.
Down to 10 seconds.
He's going to take the penalty. He's going to take the penalty.
Take the penalty, bring out Delbert Alvarado.
That's right. He's going to take the penalty and bring out the field goal kicker. And the South Florida players are upset. Jim Leavitt saying, relax. Let's go. Let's go just tie it up right here.
It's been a tale of two kickers tonight. Wes Byram, 2 for 2 from 49 and 46. And the trials and travails of Delbert Alvarado, 1 for 5, 1 blocked, 2 wide left.
Yeah, and the situation is the same as it was the last time. It's still on the hash mark on this side. It's going to be a tough angle. And even with the penalty, you know, Auburn declines that, so that doesn't mean anything. Here he is. First one is left. He comes back with a field goal that is shanked and is even further left and almost out of the end zone. And then he has one blocked and finally splits the sticks. They're trying to give him a checkup from the neck up and get rid of that stinking thinking, but he's got a tough angle here, I'm telling you.
He missed from 21 yards out the last time, just barely outside the left upright.
And if you're playing defense, beware of the fake.
This one from 19 yards out.
This is the ball game.
This will tie it. Or it will be the ball game. Severino to put it down. Alvarado's got it. Tie ball game. Delbert Alvarado from 19 yards out.
Don't go to bed yet, folks. We've got 55 seconds left and we're tied at 20. Little South Florida. You know, that's a misnomer, too. South Florida now has 45,000 students and is the 9th largest university in America.
And people that call it a commuter school are calling it wrong because, according to Jim Leavitt, they have more beds on campus than Florida State University.
Jim Leavitt continues to build this program. He said he wants to be able to be mentioned in the same paragraph with Miami and Florida State and Florida. He wins here tonight. He'll be doing that. He beat Louisville 2 years ago, went up to Morgantown, beat 7th-ranked West Virginia last year. Alvarado over there in the corner praying.
He knows he may have to kick another field goal before the night's out. I'd be praying, too. That drive was set up by that fantastic kickoff return by Jerome Murphy of 59 yards. And again, now, Tim, you talked about the ball being kicked off from the 30 and the potential for long kickoff returns. It's interesting to see what South Florida does here with Tichy, whether he kicks it deep or tries to pooch it.
Don't celebrate yes, folks. Come on.
Ben Tate and Mario Fannin are deep for the Tigers.
You're on the kickoff team, you got to stay in your lanes. If you're on the receiving end right there, you've got to get as much as you possibly can.
Well, Tichy kicks it away. And that's Fannin. Across the 30. Fannin knocked out of bounds at the 37-yard line. And he held on to the ball.
So now Brandon Cox has two timeouts and 49 seconds to work with to get it down in field goal range.
And that's the key, because he has a solid kicker tonight in Wes Byram. He's hit from 49 yards and from 46 yards just moments ago. The 49-yarder, of course, was a career long. But first things first, here's Cox. A lot of time to throw now to Tommy Trott, too far out of bounds. Good coverage by Nate Allen.
No, and that's a good play by Cox, too. Some of his best passes are incompletions, and I mean that seriously. Everybody was covered. He had wasted a lot of time back there. Just throw it out of bounds. So he throws it away, gives him another play at second and 10. Sideline is your friend now. You move the chains, you stop the clock. You've got 42 seconds to go. You can't waste too much time.
...36-yard line for the second and 10. Four-man rush by the Bulls. Cox avoids the first guy, but not the second.
You need a timeout here.
Got away from Jared Bowie. And then Aaron Harris wrapped him up.
You're down to 29 seconds. You need a timeout. He's not taking one. He's got two left.
Yeah, he believes he'd win with defense and special teams.
And the Boo Birds are...
Oh, boy. You
Boo Birds are coming out. I don't know. You've got a strong leg in your kicker. You've got to use those sidelines in the passing game to get down into field goal range. He's playing for overtime.
And these fans don't like it one bit.
He just gave South Florida an even playing field again.
Well, they get time to rest.
Time to rest and start over a whole new period.
So we got a tie game here in Auburn, Alabama. South Florida 20, Auburn 20. When we come back, we'll have overtime. Back at Jordan-Hare Stadium in Auburn, Alabama, we're going to overtime. South Florida 20, Auburn 20. Tommy Tuberville electing to run the clock out to set up this overtime. Here are the overtime rules, and I like these overtime rules. Coin toss for the choice of going on offense, defense, or choosing the end of the field. Each team gets one possession from the opponent's 25-yard line per overtime until a winner is decided. No game clock now, we just have the play clock. And you must go for a two-point conversion starting with the third overtime. USF likes overtime, apparently.
Here's what I like. You've got a football program in Auburn that started in 1892, and you've got this guy's football program that started in 1997. And look at the overtime record. South Florida's 4-0, Auburn 3-4. Even playing field, 2020, line them up, let's go.
Well, in 03, they had three overtime games. They beat Louisville, they beat Cincinnati, and they beat East Carolina. The following year, they took TCU to task, beating them 45-44 in OT.
South Florida won the toss and will defend this goal. Gentlemen, shake hands. Let's have a great overtime.
Okay. Shows you perhaps how tired the Auburn team is. Tuberville elects to send out his holder, Matthew Motley, for the coin toss to start overtime. There's a tired Tiger fan, too.
Well, it doesn't get much better than this. You talk about some of the stories. Michigan lost to Oregon today, 39-7. Lloyd Carr under a lot of pressure. Notre Dame was beaten up. Clawson was beaten up there at Happy Valley. Penn State beat them, so Notre Dame goes to 0-2. Now you got South Florida playing Auburn. SEC 2020 heading into overtime. We started the game. You asked if upsets were possible. They sure have been talking about this game.
But if this game comes down to a field goal, I think Auburn has a distinct advantage. First and 10 for the Tigers. Tate gets the ball left side, and he'll get two or three. Nate Allen coming up quickly along with Bruce Montpremier.
Thing is about overtime, you cannot think about being in an overtime situation. You have to play just as hard, look at the situations the same, as if you're playing at the end of the fourth quarter.
Yeah, a real advantage for the team that wins the toss. They go on defense. They know what they have to do when they get the ball on offense.
Well, that's true, but my point is you can't put more added pressure on you.
Tommy Trott is in motion. Fake to Tate. Pass to Trott, and he drops the ball. He had running room, too, along that left side.
Boy, did he ever.
But Selby, with great pressure on the quarterback, forced that quick throw.
Tommy Trott's one of those 250-pound guys, and the ball was a little bit high and a little bit behind him, and he tried to twist, and the big body wouldn't allow it. Watch five slip out. Here comes the ball. It's a little bit high, and he's just fighting it. Boy, he had all the room you wanted out there.
He's too big to wear number five.
Here's third and long.
Yes, it is. Third and eight. From the shotgun. Cox. Over the middle, incomplete. Robert Dunn never had a shot at it.
No, but a well-thrown ball has that inside the five, maybe even a score, because he was open. He was between the corner and the safety.
Carlton Williams, number 32, perhaps distracted.
Well, Cox read the safety. He just had to fit that thing in there. Williams was late coming over. Good read, poor execution.
Boy, this is a big field goal by Wes Byram of 40 yards.
And again, he's hit from 49 and 46.
And there's our man, Matthew Motley, to put it down. Low kick. Good. Oh, my.
He just bangs him in there, doesn't he? That was just power. He missed the ball and still got it there.
He hit the top half of this ball,
I think. That's what I mean. He hit it on the hosel, and he still got it through. Look at this thing.
They're going to call it officially a 39-yarder, but it is 3 points for the Tigers. So the Bulls know they need a touchdown. They can win this ball game. Key thing here, though, for the Bulls is not take a sack. They take a sack, they really put their field goal kicker in a very tough situation.
Not only a sack, no negative yardage.
First and 10 from the 25 for Grothy. Mike Ford, fake to Ford. Grothy's got it. He's got 3 yards on that left side.
Ryan Schmidt now, the left guard, comes up lifting. He's in pain.
Yeah, but Mark Dial's back in the game, as is Walter Walker.
Keep in mind, they're playing without their starting center. Capogna injured his knee. Griffin's taking his place. Dial went out and came back, and now Schmidt has cramps.
3 yards for Grothy. Again, the fake to Ford. Grothy's got it. He's got about four this time. Same play. We're in overtime. Auburn up by three. Jim Leavitt agonizing on the sidelines. He knows he may have a tough decision to make real soon.
Well, they kept the ball in the middle of the field. That's a positive. Let's see if they can get the first.
This time he gives it to Ford. And Ford is close to a first down.
Oh, I don't know if he got a good mark. He's going to be short where they marked it.
Remember, that yellow line is unofficial. He had to get to the 15-yard line. The line judge, Terry Walters, came in quickly and said he comes up just a bit short.
Watch where the ball is when he hits. And then watch where the mark is.
I tell you, they ought to review that one, I think. Every play is supposedly reviewed.
They're going for it here. Here's ball game right here.
Fourth and inches. Grothy will go under center.
Quarterback sneak.
He's got the first down. Matt Grothy with a huge play on the quarterback sneak.
Want a submarine in the center, because you know the quarterback sneak is coming. Auburn's defensive line came high. That's where you want to get as low as you can and knife into the gap, create a line of scrimmage a yard deep in South Florida's. But here he pushes forward, so South Florida's still alive.
Give Jake Griffin, Zach Herman, and Ryan Schmidt a lot of credit for that first down. Fake to Ford. Grothy's got it again. Cuts back and only picks up 1 yard.
Surprised he's not throwing for the end zone. And the guy I'd be looking for is Amari Jackson. And again, I reiterate, he's 6'5", going against 5'9", corners. Just put it up there and let him go up for it.
No gain on the play. Second down, 10.
Right in front of the student section. And they're doing their best to make it tough on Matt Grothy.
Here he is right here. 6'5 guy.
Grothy throws the other way.
Got it.
He's got a touchdown, South Florida, and the Bulls upset Auburn. Jesse Hester with a touchdown reception from Matt Grothy from 14 yards out, and the Bulls are going crazy. Jesse Hester Jr. with his first career touchdown, and I bet his daddy is doing somersaults right now.
First of all, he had great protection. Secondly, Hester beat the safety Brock, who was late coming over. The ball was perfectly thrown. I think Auburn was looking for Amari Jackson as well. They knew he was on the other side. They almost used him as a decoy.
Donnie?
Well, Fife, you wouldn't know it, but Coach Leavitt's a pretty happy man right now. Coach, when Delbert missed that last field goal, what did you tell him when he came off the field?
Well, you know, that he's got to keep his head up because he's going to have to kick a field that could win the game for us.
When you had that fourth and one, what was the play call, and what did you tell him, Matt? What was the last bit of instruction you gave him?
Oh, you mean right in here on the quarterback sneak? Well, we were going to go for it a few inches. I didn't think the spot was well. I didn't want to put it in the hands of Delbert on that one for the 18, so we were going to attack, quarterback sneak it.
Down here when you went for the tie instead of going for the win there, what did you tell your players? Because a lot of them really wanted to go for the win there.
That was a tough decision. It's just a gut feeling. You just go. It was a tough angle. But, you know, I went for the overtime. You know, I don't know.
We talked to you the other night about how big this game was. How big of a win is this for the University of South Florida program?
It's huge for the Big East. Certainly, it's huge for University of South Florida. It's great for the city of Tampa, that's for sure.
Congratulations, Coach.
Thank you very much.
Dan?
Thank you, Todd. A signature win for the program, a win over a ranked non-conference team. USF 5-0 in overtime now.
This game is a program maker for South Florida. The win over Louisville was big. The win over West Virginia was huge. This win at Auburn is a program maker.
Our final score, USF 26, Auburn 23 in overtime. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com.